Edison's. So, oh, actually, I mean, you can't bring your podcast shit down. All right.
It's gonna be a lot of fun, man. Hello, and welcome to the Jason Cavness Experience. I'm your host, Jason Cavness. The Jason Cavness Experience is brought to you by CavnessHR. At CavnessHR, we provide HR to companies with 49 or fewer people by automating HR with our tech platform and providing you with the HR business partner. Our guest today is Dr. Conrad Webster. Dr. Webster, how you doing today?
I'm doing good. I'm doing good. Excited to be here.
Thanks. Do you want to call you Dr. Webster, Trey, Conrad?
We can go Dr. Webster.
Okay,
cool. Yeah, I paid for it. It was a lot of money.
Yeah, you're in that shit, right? So, Dr. Webster, a few years ago, so one thing, I have no concept of time anymore, right? So, this might have happened last year, 10 years ago, but there was a horrible hurricane happening in Houston, right?
Yeah.
And you went back there and did a lot of stuff to the community, provided service. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, Hurricane Harvey. This was the first time in history that a hurricane actually stayed over a city. And the hurricane stayed over our city for about 2 days. So when the impact hit, I wanted to do something special for people who have been impacted and affected. So I went down there and got as much like therapists that I've had met to give them some type of care to work through trauma, anxiety, and depression. Also having folks from different state donate clothes, canned goods, because a lot of people didn't have access to a Walmart or a Target or anything like that. And lines just kept getting bigger and bigger. I mean, a slice of bread.
Isn't FEMA supposed to do that shit though?
FEMA was supposed to do that, but FEMA hasn't been great since Katrina. If we're going to be honest, that's when FEMA was just giving everybody money. But
so we're paying tax money for FEMA and not doing their job.
Pretty much.
Okay.
Pretty much. So, you know, it was a big success. We had a lot of folks from different state send out canned goods and things of that sort. And, you know, our city is still kind of recovering in certain areas, but we're on the up and up. And as you can see, we're still one of the main attractions in the United States for folks to come down to.
And didn't they have a big flood recently too?
Yeah, so we just got hit about a couple of days ago. It was a thunderstorm that had winds up to 90 miles that hit downtown.
That's hurricane level, right?
Tornado, like a F2. And we had a couple tornadoes touch down in other areas of our greatest city, Houston areas. So like Cypress and Pearland.
Okay.
Yeah.
So one thing I don't think people realize is how big Houston is, right? I could be wrong, but Houston is actually bigger than the state of Rhode Island, I think. There's a state like Rhode Island, Vermont, one of those states in the Northeast that Houston is actually bigger than.
Yeah. I would say probably Connecticut.
It's one of those Northeastern states. Yeah, like.
We're real, real, real big. So if I had to make a comparison of a distance in the state of Washington, it would be from Lakewood to Linwood,
okay,
going north and south. And if we're going east and west, man, I don't know no major cities outside of like Seattle to Bellevue going east and west. So, but it's further out more than that too.
Cheers.
Cheers.
So next subject, kind of off the subject, who are some of your favorite Houston rappers?
Oh man, you got Carter, you got Propane, Slim Thug.
I don't know the first two. I know Slim Thug.
Slim Thug.
I know Slim Thug. Paul Wall.
Ghetto Boys. Scarface, you know, he's from the area that I grew up in the south side of Houston, Texas, which is like historical for the birth of Houston music. But no, Carter, he's a rapper. He's been on the scene for a long time. He went out to L.A., picked up his stardom, came back to the city, and, you know, has been making some hits and some movements for a lot of people in the underground scene. So
you think Houston's rap scene is underrated?
Oh yeah. I feel like we don't get as much of respect because of just our sound. You know, a lot of people don't listen to DJ Screw.
What's the music sound DJ Screw does?
He screws and chops it.
Yeah.
But a lot of people adopt it in their music. They don't do the whole screwed and chopped thing, but they adopt it in their music and then make it sound like it's theirs. But it came from music.
I know one thing, like whenever somebody gives a top five, like hip hop rappers, like I think it's a crime that Scarface is not the top five, right?
Oh, who's in your top five? Who's your top five?
Oh man. So for me, it's number one Chuck D from Fuck With Enemy.
What?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
My top five, Chuck D. And then Chuck D's number one, Notebook in Order. Plus they would change if you ask me this an hour later, okay. Right? Chuck D, LL Cool J, Ice Cube, Eminem, and maybe Cool J Rap.
No Tupac or Biggie.
No.
Wow.
They're not number five. So Biggie, like to me, it's hard to put in your top five. You have two albums, right?
Okay. Okay. So we're going off like, you know.
It was just impact. Yeah, Biggie's top five with impact, right?
Okay.
Like you judge impact, lyricist, whatever, you know. Yeah, to me, Biggie's like, I don't know. So it's only two albums.
What about Nas and Jay-Z? You don't even got Nas and Jay-Z?
I mean, you know.
You was naming all East Coast rappers. Yeah. So I'm like.
To me, it's like Chuck D, LL Cool J. So now I want to take out Cool J Rap and put Eric in there.
Eric, okay.
Or then maybe take out LL, put fucking Big Daddy Kane in there.
I was about to say, you don't got Big Daddy Kane? Okay. Yeah. Big Daddy Kane's cool. But you still didn't put Scarface in there. You even said Eminem.
You know what?
You even said Eminem.
I totally forgot Scarface. That fucking fast.
See, y'all hear this, right?
Yeah. So, okay, let me do it. Okay. Chuck D, LL Cool J, Eminem, Scarface, and man, I want to put someone from the South in there, but.
I mean, you already put Scarface.
Yeah, Scarface.
You already put Scarface. You ain't got Uncle Luke?
No. He's more of an entertainer.
I mean, Michael Jackson was an entertainer.
I mean, if I want to play something to make girls get naked, it's Uncle Luke. It's Uncle Luke, you know?
Okay.
I mean, there's so many good rappers there out there, right?
It is.
And like, I didn't even mention Kendrick Lamar. Or J. Cole, you know.
Kendrick's cool. I like Kendrick. I think you gotta have an acquiring taste for Kendrick. He's such a great lyricist. He's phenomenal. Oh, yeah. He's out of this world.
Yeah, he doesn't get it for me. Like some people are like I can't get into Common. I just don't.
Common's good though. Common's really good.
He's good, yeah. What's the thing? I can't say his name. Talib Kweli.
Talib Kweli.
Yeah, you know, I'm not a big fan of his.
He's good too.
Yeah, there's a lot of good people out there. Right?
All of those are like conscious rappers and or people who rapping with a purpose. And I think sometimes it's just what you like. Some people don't like.
We haven't mentioned like, you know, Run DMC, Houdini, you know.
We put them in the top five? I mean.
See, I don't know. You know, they did not, you know, you got Melly Mel, you know, like. Like, I mean, is it top five that started everything?
But you said longevity was part of the top five. You didn't put Snoop Dogg in that. Snoop Dogg has the longest longevity of mostly any West Coast rap outside of E-40.
I mean, that's true. But, however, comma, like, when was the last time you did a good album, though, right?
That's subjective.
So, are you saying Snoop Lion, his reggae album was a banger?
I ain't saying that. I'm not saying that, but... I think he has an audience who want to hear that. Yeah. He also did a church album. His first time.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't listen to it.
He turns out no money.
I didn't listen to it, but he is versatile. You ain't even say Andre 3000, Big Boy. Yeah.
It's hard, right?
Outkast. Come on, man. A-Ball, MJG, like 3-6 Mafia. There's a lot of groups. Too Short. Too Short's dope.
There's a lot of people out there, right?
Man, but no
Beastie Boys.
Beastie Boys, they gotta be. If we're talking hip hop, they gotta be somewhere in there.
The thing is, like, is it top five lyricists, entertainment? You know, so many ways. Like, everyone's top five is the top five, right? It kills me. Like, you see on the time on Facebook, my top five are this. You're fucking trash. You don't know shit about hip hop. You know,
people are gonna go crazy, man. Especially if you don't have, you know, Biggie and Tupac in there. I really like Tupac and Biggie. I think they definitely made an impact, but it wasn't an acquiring sound for me to like keep going after our group up. Yeah. Like, you always pay respect to them because, I mean, they're legends. They're one of the
best
who ever did it.
So you know how Biggie had two albums, he died, is like instant like superstar status, right?
Mm-hmm.
What if DMX would have died after his first two albums? Do you think he would have been thought of the same as like Tupac and Biggie? His two albums are fucking bangers, right?
Oh no, I think well, yeah, it was
like
it was
Party in Here, Startup, all the songs he had, right?
It was,
he dominated for a while.
Yeah. I mean, he had a good run. He had a good,
you know who
good
I forgot?
2-3 year run.
You know if I got KRS-One.
KRS-One. Yeah. I mean, Busta Rhymes.
For a while, Nelly was dominating it, right?
Nelly had a diamond album.
Yeah.
Diamond rap album. That's hard.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't give him enough credit for that.
No.
Right. But, you know, even then he was fighting for his respect because people don't like the Lou and how they talk.
For a long time, him and KRS-One were going at it for some reason.
Yeah. I think because hip hop changed. Like, that's the good thing about hip hop. Like, it can be so many different things. And I think some people just stay on the category of like, it got to be lyricism. It's like, we don't want to hear all of that country stuff all the time.
No, you got to party sometimes.
Like, I want to party I don't even want to hear about that. I want to hear about where I'm from and things that happen where I'm from. And then when I want to switch back, I can go listen to a comic.
Remember when Diggable Planets threw jazz in there and stuff?
Yeah.
Oh, see, here's one for you. How about, man, I can't think of the group. But the head, the rapper was Guru.
Guru, Gangstar. MF Doom, he was, man, dope. You know what?
I never knew about him like a couple years ago. I knew fucking who the guy was.
Yeah.
Like he had a good career, but it was like unknown, right? It's like his whole career was underground, right?
It's a lot of guys like that. That's why I said hip hop is just so broad and it got so many different artists. You could just choose. Like, we just had Benny the Butcher out here the other day.
I remember one time that some magazine did the top 100 rappers, mm-hmm. and they put Snoop Dogg at 20, like 23, 24. And then you're like, are you pissed? Like, I said, are you pissed? You're like, dude, there's 1,000 rappers in LA alone. I'm top 23. I'm fucking happy as shit. Like,
that's tough. He lucky he got that. Some people would have had him lower than that. Who's in the top 20?
I don't remember. It's like,
wow.
Some of these groups, like magazines come to the groups, you're like, how the fuck is he top 10, right?
Yeah.
Like, who the fuck is this, right?
Yeah.
And then, like, you have people like MZ Ren. He wasn't half bad, you know? I mean, and plus, like, you know, backing, all that kind of stuff.
I feel like we give 90s rap so much credit.
That's what kind of blew up, right?
Yeah, it blew up hip-hop, the 90s rap, 80s, 90s rap. But I'm like, these guys in the 2000s, they made some huge impacts and changed the game in some ways.
Who's some of your favorite rappers now?
Man.
Like the new school, so to speak.
New school. Okay. So, because that would include like Kendrick Lamar, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll say J. Cole, Big Sean. Big Sean's dope.
I haven't heard nothing from him for a while.
He had a baby and, had dad life and stuff. Big Crit.
Oh, man, I forgot about him. Shit.
Yeah.
That song he has, what's that song he has? Like Texas, Learning Texas.
Learning from Texas. You're
learning from
Texas,
yeah, that's a good song.
Big XO to plug. He got the song called Texas. It's Dallas theme song.
Oh man. Have you heard of Mexican OT?
Yeah, Mexican OT.
I like him, yeah.
Mexican OT, cool. He did the rodeo. It's just sad that nobody like kind of knew who he was. Uh-huh. I knew who he was, but you know. Sauce Walker. He's really good. And I'ma keep it at that. I mean, Kendrick. I can listen to Kendrick.
Yeah.
I can't do a whole album, but I know his greatness.
Yeah,
I just can't do a whole album.
I Kendrick Lamar with him, of course, I think he's gonna be like really famous 100 years from now, right? They're gonna look back on history like, oh shit, this guy's like really good, right?
Yeah, I will put him on an Andre 3000 status where I'm like, he's the great lyricist. He has good songs, great songs, but he just doesn't get enough respect because he doesn't consistently put out something.
Yeah.
But the battle with him and Drake is funny. Yeah. Oh, and I like Drake. Who doesn't like his music?
Yeah.
Like, he's always on the scene.
I know Drake's been like got a lot of criticism lately for his lyrics and stuff. Because the thing, like, there's a TikTok, you're like, I'm re-listening to these Drake lyrics, and it's like one lyric goes like, oh, from the, I can't remember the song. I can't remember what the basic lyric was. You're a hottie. You was a hottie back in your high school days. You know, like, You know, he's been accused, like, you know, grooming females and shit, you know.
I don't believe that. I think as an entertainer, sometimes, and if they say it's people writing his lyrics, you know, sometimes you are battling three different monsters.
Yeah.
You have you as an entertainer who got here, but you got here on the merit of somebody saying this is what you have to do to make
Yeah.
these millions,
Yeah.
right? And then these people are saying you got to rap this, you got to go here, you got to do this. I mean,
And what people don't realize, like back in the day, rock stars, they were something that if you look at like what's it called, presentism, present, if you look back, like the Rolling Stones had a song called Brown Sugar, based like it was based on having sex with like black female teenager, right?
Oh, whoa, wait.
Yeah. So back in the day, like you had all these rock stars, like, and plus that, like, you know, this you know the group what's it called? Aerosmith, the lead
Yeah,
singer.
yeah.
I bet you don't know this. So when he's like, the band's like 26, 27, this couple was such a big fan of his. They give their daughter, 14-year-old daughter for adoption to him, right?
Oh, no.
So he adopted his 14-year-old daughter, and of course did all kind of fucking sexual deprivation shit, right? And that's how rock and roll was back in the day, right? Like Jerry Lee Lewis, 27, married his 14-year-old cousin. Elvis Presley, 26. Lisa Marie was like 15, 16. So that's the norm back in the day, right?
Yeah, I don't condone none of
Yeah.
that as damn this child sex trafficking.
Yeah.
Yeah,
But
no.
I mean, yes, I was back in the day. And like, here's something for you. So my aunt, she did our family history back to Europe, like 13, 1400, right? Back to Italy, right? So yeah, back to Italy, 1400 years. So reading their history, right? This is fucking insane, right? So as recently as the 1890s, 1910, 1920s, and my family back in Italy, 27, 20-year-old, like, dudes would marry the 14, 15, 16-year-old cousin, right? I'm like, man, no wonder my fucking family's so mentally fucked up, right?
That's like some Game of Thrones type thing that's
It is,
going
right?
on.
But of course, that's how it was back in the day, right?
Yeah, I'm glad that we are not like that back in the
No, it's some
day.
insane shit.
Yeah,
But
but
so moving on. What do you do for fun? Your hobbies? Like, do you even have time for fun and hobbies?
oh man, shoot, I like to play with my son a lot. I got a 1-year-old. I like to shop. I like to go out. I like to read. I like to travel, go to different cities, and like really just try out the food. I'm a foodie person, so it's mostly what I do. And I write a lot. So I try to write different articles and journals about things that happen in politics, things that happen in our communities, and like level the language to like where people can understand it. So yeah.
So what's your writing process? You lock yourself in a room, like nothing at all except a pen and paper, or you have like a TV on, radio on? Like, what's your writing process?
That's funny that you asked that. I got like three different ones. It depends on what I'm writing about. So if I'm writing about things that's happening in the community, I would literally go out to, you know, the areas where they say, hey, this is like where a lot of poverty is happening, right? And I just sit there for hours. I'm like looking, seeing. I'm like, all right, so this is how it is, how it be. If I'm thinking about like politics and I want to like catch the reader, I watch Jordan Peele movies. Yeah, it was interesting because he has like a lot of hidden gems in there, and I was just like keep watching it, keep rewatching it. I'm like, okay, oh, I missed that one. I didn't see this one. I'm like, all right, this is how I want my writing style to be. I want to, when you read it, it's like a whole movie to you, and then you could just keep replaying and replaying. So that's like it's my, and then the third one is not to lock myself in a room, but like I'll watch sports. I'll put on like a rewatch like a old Kobe YouTube video and like hear him talk about like the grind and the grit of like studying your opponent. And I'll be like, okay, what do I want to write? What is the flaw? Where's the gap? And then I just get into it.
So talk about your great track and field career.
Man, I wouldn't say it was great.
You got your scholarships though, right?
I wouldn't say it was super great, but
You ran the
it's
200 and 400.
yeah, I was a late bloomer, like a real late bloomer. I started off playing basketball and football, went to high school called A. Leaf Taylor. We had some phenomenal athletes there. And like football, it worked out for me, but I was more better at basketball. And I played AAU with my little brother, Nick Okori. And from there, I had picked up some scholarships. So going to different schools, and I got kicked out of two schools. Got kicked out of Texas Southern University of Houston. And I was like, I need a way out. You know what I'm saying? So I had family up in Seattle. And I was like, come up here. So I had tried out for a local community college basketball team. And then I'm like, I really want to switch sports because keep doing this sport, I always get in trouble. It don't matter where it is, I always get in trouble. And then I picked up on track. We did good our first year. And then we got to the championships. I hurt my leg. And then the second year, this is like our big year of like all of our 4x4 and 4x1 track stars. We all got scholarships to Division I schools. One went to Oregon, other went to Wazoo, another one went to UW, and I went to Seattle U.
So looking back, when you got kicked out of the Texas Southern, did you deserve to get kicked out?
Yeah, I was stealing laptops. You're
doing the fucking Cameron Newton.
It was bad. And look, Texas Southern just comes on my watch. I was stealing laptops because I had to pay back University of Houston. And, you know, I thought at the time, like, I was doing myself justice by paying back this bill. And I was taking laptops that was, like, sitting there from students. And I would resell them for, like, $150. It didn't matter what the laptop was. And then I ended up stealing a TSU laptop, and they tracked it. And they're like, all right, come off the laptop. And I'm like, how do you know I got this? Like I was like, a poor criminal.
They're like, motherfucker.
Yeah. It's like a poor criminal back then. So, yeah, luckily, you know, I just had to pay a fine and, you know, let me go from the school.
So now, taking that experience, how do you, like, mentor young people now not to make those mistakes? Like, how do you make them, like, how do you influence people to change their mentality, so to speak?
Well, I first opened up with stories like that, you know, like where I was mentally in my head and what I thought a good out route could have been, right? And have them process those type of thoughts from themselves. Like, where is it where you think you have hit rock bottom that you need to do something like that? Or you have to rob, or you have to fight, or you have to do things that may impact your character, for one. And then also, you may end up in jail. You know, I was fortunate and lucky enough that TSU did not press charges on me. Or the people who, you know, I stole these things from. So I give that big landscape of, you know, where I was at, what happened, what could have happened, and then have them work through it, seeing how they can interrupt those processes by just slowing down and being patient.
You know what? That's a good question. Talk about that. Like, so many people, regardless of your age, they want everything now. Like, I want $1 million now. I start a company. I want to be rich. I want to be Bill Gates today.
Yeah.
But whatever you do, it's a fucking process, right? Like people don't remember Steve Jobs and Wozniak. Apple didn't come after like 8 years later, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mark Zuckerberg coded in his dorm room for like 6-7 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, Kobe Bryant didn't become the Mamba. Maybe Kobe Bryant did come to the Mamba when he was born, right?
Came early.
Yeah, he came early, yeah, right. But you get my point, right? Like, talk about the importance of teaching people, regardless of age, like patience. Like, you got to trust the process, so to speak.
I first talk about there's an order in your life, right? We don't know what that order is or what that process looks like until we find purpose. I think purpose is one of the biggest things that we all strive for and look for when we are identifying whom we are. Sometimes people's purpose lies within a family. Sometimes it lies within the sport that you want to play. Or it's your church and you have a higher being that you look up to. And I think once you find what the purpose is, your order starts manifesting for you. Like, how do I take these steps to get to where I want to be, right? Everything is not a fast track, like you said. Like, yeah, I think everybody wants $1 million, like right now. Like, please give me that. And there's some outliers. And we get a lot of outliers, and they promote it on social media like, well, I didn't go to college, but look, I got $50 million. And we did this on YouTube, and now we're streamers and stuff like that. But what I do is, with that order, is I'm like, okay, these are outliers, but how does it look on a day-to-day basis when we don't have certain things in our community to get us there, right? And what is ways that we have to utilize the resources that we have to think bigger and broader? And when I say bigger and broader, I'm thinking of it in two contexts. Bigger is just to look locally up in your space of like how I can think outside of just this local area. And sometimes it goes regional. Broader is to say, how do we take this order and put it into a context of international? We don't just have to stay here for our order in the United States. Like, people are going back to Africa. They're finding richness there. Some people are going over there to Italy, Canada. They're going to Brazil, and they're finding things about themselves that makes them feel whole. I never thought I was going to come to Seattle. Like, that wasn't a thing in my head. Some people don't even make it out of Houston. So I was like, what can I do? Because I kept getting in trouble in Houston. And luckily, I had family that stayed in Seattle. And they got a rich history in Seattle, too. And they opened their doors up for me and provided me the opportunity to be who I wanted to be, right? And the first thing that Robin Holloway told me, shout out to her, is to find your purpose, find who you are. And sometimes who you are won't show up as a positive for other people, because whatever their positive is their positives. But like, when you find out who you are, that's going to fit you and make you want to drive to do whatever that is. So for me, it's healing Black men. I come from a family who, you know, we didn't show much affection. And I was just talking to my pops the other day. I'm like, yo, like, I ain't never seen you really kiss my mom or like hug my mom like that. He was like, yeah, my dad didn't do that. And I'm like, yeah, but that kind of impacted me in my relationships. Like, I ain't know what to do. And they like, why you don't hug me? So just going through those cycles and like just understanding, like, once you find that order, everything's going to work itself out.
You have a good point. I think like too many people, they're like, this might be a bad example. Like, somebody might be a high school running back, right? And they're thinking, they're like, my competition is all the running backs of the district. No, it's every running back in the United States in high school, right? Mm-hmm. Or if you're competing for a medical degree, this is not your local college, right? It's everyone, mm-hmm. right? I think people mm-hmm. have this mindset, it's only like localized competition. You're competing against motherfuckers in China, Russia, mm-hmm. India. Like, I think we got to get that mind frame, so to speak, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you have to be competing against everyone, right?
Yeah, so I take it, I'm going to go back to the sports analogy. So, you think of a kid, I'm going to use Percy Harvin. Harvin. Percy Harvin is, he was like 5'9", all world speed, right?
Athletic, off the chart.
But that was his niche. He was very, very fast. No, he couldn't, you know, be the strongest receiver out there. Couldn't do that. Maybe he wasn't the best route runner also, but he had world-class speed.
Yeah.
So he's going to beat others out because of that speed. And he knows that he has to keep training, and stay on the field because of that speed. Other folks, when they get into this type of sport, we think our unique abilities is something that our coach tells us, right? But sometimes you have to look at the biggest landscape and be like, hey, I'm not 220. This is what's getting drafted in the NFL. So what is my niche that I can be like, this is what I got, and this is how I can be utilized? You got the guy from Dallas. His dad was on the staff, Deuce Vaughn.
Deuce Vaughn, he's like 5'1" or something.
So he's super fast. He is, right? And yeah, they don't utilize him that much.
He's 5'6", you know, he's 5'6".
They don't utilize him that much, but he's super fast. So it's going to be a time where we can use speed. And Percy Harvin, he had a lot of concussions and some injuries, but
it's some off the field issues.
It's some off the field issues, but he was able to provide for his family because of that niche.
Yeah.
So folks have to find what their niche is. Like, my niche is I'm out here trying to heal Black men. We have so many issues that's going on in our community that we don't talk about. We don't talk about how we disrespect African-American women or just women in the whole. We don't talk about the rapes that happen in our community. You know what I'm saying? That leads to from toxic masculinity. We don't talk about, you know, the family trauma and how we kind of hold on to things that come from our parents that we feel like was actually great because at the time it built us who we are, but the times has changed. So like, how do you adapt with that? So
on social media, what do you hear or you see as something where a Black female puts Black men ain't shit? What's your reaction to that?
Well, I ain't gonna just jump like, yeah, girl, Black man, because I'm a Black male. But I can understand. I can understand why she or they may have said that, you know what I'm saying, in that moment, because that's their truth, right? But I would try to change it by saying, okay, whom you have had dealings with or have experience with, that may have been the case, but there's other people out there and other men out there with quality that's like, nah, we want to uplift you and treat you a certain way. But it's hard to come across that sometimes, depending on our environment, pretending on what we have reached to, because we don't talk about the reach. We just talk about, oh, I'm just over here in Houston in the Southwest side. Well, in the North side, we got this. You know what I'm saying? There's another reach to it. But if you can't get to the North side, you ain't going to get it.
Yeah, that's a good point. So next, what is race equity? Like, what's the, give like a dummies 101 layman's, what is race equity?
Oh my gosh.
I'm pretty sure you talk for 10 hours.
Man, I talk about this all the time with my students at the University of Washington and Pierce College. Race equity to me is understanding the awareness and the capacity of a race does to you mentally, physically. And also the rite of passage for you to have access to things, right? As having a race-based foundation in the United States, it's very biased on who gathers information, who has the opportunities to have fair and equitable housing, equitable leadership, equitable HR, and also education, right? And it's breaking up those dynamics and those intersections to talk about how we need to have a, not a super level playing field, but a field to where folks who have had the worst injustice having a voice, not just at the table, but just a voice, period, to make change. I think we often talk about the table too much. And it's not like we have a metaphorical table to put people at, because we know how this country is ran. It doesn't matter if we had 40% of the people in the House seats. Like, that's not going to do anything if the country is ran by those, you know, those votes, right? And some of the times, even our folks who are Black and brown still have white supremacy practices in them. And what we mean by white supremacy practices, the practices that inherently are meant to oppress other people. And we're talking about when the other people are people of color.
Is there such a thing as economic equity?
Yeah. Yeah, most definitely. Well, if you look at our country right now, and we always talk, and I'm doing it on a level field. We talk about the have and the have nots, right? The haves are the elitists who have historically benefited from racism. So in this country, whites, firstborn here, you have Indian culture who have assimilated, who have benefited from the assimilation.
You have Indian, you mean the country India or?
The country India, not Indian people. And then you have Asian Americans, who have benefited from them. Not all Asian Americans, I would say, have benefited from them, but the majority have. And that's just how the country is shaped. Even if they didn't want to assimilate, there was a battle of, like, you know, how can we still get what we need in this country, even though they were fighting with white people. I mean, even in China and Japan, you know, white America has been oppressing people from the wars and stuff. But when it came over here, there was given a greater opportunity than African American folks or Latin American folks or Chicano and Chicana. In our Native Americans also. So when we talk about economics, because of that historical history, a lot of folks are still battling with how we get into a level playing field or field to where our injustices are catching up. So the 40 acres and the mule, like, how do we get our land back? How do our Native Americans get their land back? It's one thing to say, hey, Muckleshoot tribe, we're going to recognize you and say, hey, we got a Muckleshoot casino for you. And we'll say, you know, the introductions that you need, but we're still not going to help your children really graduate from school. We're not going to bring in therapists to, you know, take away some of that trauma that's been happening in your community from this historical oppression of what we've been doing for hundreds of years. We're also not going to show you what to do with your money and how to build up those communities.
So this is
going
to sound fucked up, right? But, like, if all the casinos are making these millions of dollars, shouldn't they be taking that money, reinvesting in the community and doing that stuff themselves?
You would think so, right? However, it's like saying, okay, I take a person who has a drug addiction off the street and I give them some money. What am I expecting you to do with it?
I mean,
you're going to still buy the drugs.
Yeah.
Because I'm not teaching you how to be clean and take that money and do something else with it. And I'm not saying that that's what I'm trying to compare it to with the Native Americans, but I'm saying with our Native American folks, some of the money that they have taken from the casino, they have invested in a few things, but we're not going to popularize it, because if we popularize it in this country, populate it
okay,
in a way to where we're seeing upward mobility, then that's going to take away of how we run this country. And then we need to do something about it, right? So now we're going to not give these Native American folks this much opportunity to do something. We got to take it away, because this land still in Washington State is our Native American folks. And we only have a certain tribes that have the opportunity to host, have these casinos. And not just a casino, like, that's one thing. Why don't we have more Native American schools? Why don't we have more Native American superintendents, like, and so on?
Native Americans have, like, the highest, like, depression rate, highest, like whatever metric is, like, bad, they're the highest, right?
Yeah,
like,
they're one of the highest.
Like,
yeah.
Like, they're even higher, like, the, you know, Mississippi is known, like, having, like, lower standard, but they're even worse than Mississippi, right?
Yeah, yeah, and they're the most instinct. Like, we talk about African-American folks, and I'm going to always, you know, uplift my African-American folks and talk about the oppressions that we have, but if we, like, really looking at it from a standpoint of, like, data, we don't talk about them. We only talk about them when we have to show face and, you know, make it seem like we're doing something really race equitable.
One thing I think is really, like, kind of fucked up, right? I'll get blasted for this, right? It's still, like, in the state of Washington, where there's, like, kind of some kind of public performance, there's always, like, 10 minutes beforehand, like, something they do, like, a little Indian, like, Native American, like, ceremony, right?
Native American ceremony.
I just think it's so performative, right? Oh, like, here's your 10 minutes for the crowd, but nothing's really being done.
Yeah, so that's right. So that's what white people do to them. And we have had a history of white folks doing that, even from the enslavement days. You know, if we wanted to trade a slave or sell a slave, enslaved person, we will make them perform. Like, how high can you jump? This person can run real fast. We're doing the same thing in the combine, in the NFL combine, in the NBA combine, MLB combine. It goes on. If you look at the statistics in all sports, it's dominated by black and brown folks, but who are the owners?
Me.
So I wrote an article about that,
yeah.
In the $1 million specimen. Well, I co-wrote with Dr. Latoya Brackett. She is a professor at the University of Puget Sound. Dope individual. We wrote an article called The Million Dollar Specimen, and we're talking about the return to play, and we're also talking about the exploitation of Black and Brown athletes and like what it has done to us in society and how sometimes our back is against the wall. Like, if we don't play in the NBA and you're not a superstar, you get cut.
Yeah.
And if you get cut, you might not make it back in the NBA because you're going to be blackballed like Colin Kaepernick, talking about issues that's happening in our community.
Like, remember that one player back in the day, he played point guard for LSU. I can't remember his name, but he played for LSU, converted Islam, got an Islamic name, played for Denver, and did something, they blackballed him. I wish I could remember what his fucking name was.
I think it was Adura. Right?
That's him. Yeah. They blackballed him.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of...
It was Chris Jackson.
Yeah. Chris Jackson. A lot of athletes have been blackballed in this industry, but we don't do enough of protecting them. Like, the moment that these folks sign contracts...
So some people say, these are fucking millionaires. Like, what do they need protection for?
Yeah, no. I mean, we can't. Yes, they are. Some are millionaires. Let's start there. Some are millionaires, but we don't know where that money is going. Like, they could have got a bad agent, and the agent is taking X amount of percent because they're getting them when they're young kids.
I had family and friends that took advantage of it.
Family and friends that took, we've seen the 30 for 30s when they say most of these NFL players are broke.
Like, Shaquille O'Neal says all the time, like, he was buying people cars and his bank account called him, Shaq, what the fuck are you doing?
Vince Young was paying $56,000 a night.
Oh, shit. So Vince Young, I don't know if you do this, but suppose Vince Young, he wanted to fly from Nashville to Houston. He would like buy the whole Southwest plane. You better buy myself. Like, dude, what the fuck are you doing, right? Just fucking buy a private jet and be done with it.
But who's coaching him? That's what I'm saying. Who's coaching Vince Young? Yeah, we have a lot of people would be like, man, you got all these yes men around you. Yeah, but them yes men are the people who are trying to get paid from them.
Yep.
So a lot of people won't step to them because they're like, this is how I get paid. Now, you can look at it from the Diddy standpoint. Sean Combs has been in a lot of fire for what he's did to Cassie. Even before Cassidy, they had reports. They had reports on what's going on.
Do you think that shit's true? Someone said they released a video or audio where he like pretty much fucked Meek Mill.
No.
Don't think that's true.
No, I don't think that's true. But
I mean, can we just say on the Shannon Sharp episode, Diddy wants a party. You gotta tell him no.
Yeah, I don't.
You gotta tell him no.
I don't think that's true. But what I do think is true that there is some exploitation of how these artists do get into the industry.
Yeah,
and they have talked about, you know, what happens at different parties or like what happens in studios, and I'm like, if we knowing these things are happening and they're happening amongst our own people, doing it to our own people, there must be something behind closed doors that's saying this is the ritual. And we gotta disrupt and dismantle the ritual. Like, why is it that when you look even in the fashion industry is owned and operated by white gay males, which is nothing wrong with that, but it's white gay males who have oppressed other folks. And it's not like they're saying, hey, let's be more inclusive and we're going to bring on Black women, Native women, all of these folks to start modeling. They're like, no, we're only going to make you model if you look a certain way.
So you think it's back to the thing where you said back in the day, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely?
Yeah, most definitely. And like, we're only going to be able to heal and change when we talk about these issues. And some of these things are going to be triggering, but like the world is triggering. We can't escape that. So the only way we get through it is to have this open conversation and be real about it. Like, this is what's happening. This is the facts. This is the data that supports the facts that we're saying as claims. And then we come into conversations where we're like, how can we get better? You know, I myself am not perfect. I tell people all the time, it took me a long time to get to the stage that I am.
I mean, you're from Texas, so you're pretty fucking close to perfect.
Yes, but like with race equity work, you know, I have not always been perfect, but I strive to be. With relationships, I haven't always been perfect, but I strive to be. Every time that there's a gap.
That's all that matters, right?
Yeah, every time that there's a gap, you just try to get better with it. Like, even with our language, like, I could say something right now, and folks would be like, cancel them. And I'm like, wait, like, that's a learning opportunity. Yeah. Because if we look at that in education, if a white person says something wrong, we'll be like, oh my gosh, just give them all this DEI training, and we don't cancel them. So, like, why automatically you cancel me? You just feel like I should know and do better more than the person who has historically been doing this oppressive language and stuff and so on.
So totally off subject, sort of kind of right, but like a couple years ago, DaBaby, right?
Yeah.
He did a song with Dua Lipa, it was really popular. Mm-hmm. And he had a concert in Miami. He said a bunch of like anti-gay, LGBT stuff. Everyone wanted to cancel him. And all the people in Miley South were like, no, wait a minute. Like, let's like educate this guy, reach out to her. This is a teacher member, right? Of all the people, Miley Cyrus, right? They want to fucking cancel him, you know, all this kind of stuff. Miley Cyrus, all people like, no, let's like, let's go talk to him, educate him, right?
Yeah.
And people like,
yeah, I think, now here's, because they wouldn't have did that to Lil Boosie. But I think with DaBaby, when I heard the audio, what I took from it was he was saying what his lifestyle is. He wasn't saying, hey, if you are doing those things that, you know, you're a bad person or something, he's just going off who he is, his sexuality and stuff like that. So let's reverse it.
And the thing is, like, back in the day, hip hop way back in the day was like real anti-gay, anti-homosexual. Like,
yeah, they were.
Would have like, you faggot, motherfucker, you. It's like,
so that language right there, you know what I'm saying? We can't use that language, but like, that right there, yeah, that's super anti-gay. Like, that's, and it's oppressive. And
things have changed now, but back in the day. But,
I mean, we still don't use that language, but he didn't say any of those things. I think what people took from it was like, because he is a heterosexual and he didn't mention that, hey, if you didn't do those things, like, you still cool. Sometimes we take things and we be like, oh, you didn't say this, so now I'm against you. Like, if I say, oh, everybody stand up, and then the person who's not able to stand up, they're like, you're not inclusive.
They have a Madonna concert recently.
Right. Like I wasn't thinking of that because I have a privilege. And sometimes we don't think about our inherited privilege, you know, every day, like walking in a room and turning the knob, or, you know, we don't have any, you know, disability access points in this building. Like, in this room, you know what I'm saying? So like, it's like, because we're so privileged, we don't think about those things. And it's not that we are trying to make people feel uncomfortable, but if you live in this privileged state, it's hard to come out of if you haven't been educated. So that's what I'm doing. I educate people on where we're at. Even as a black male, I have a privileged standpoint because white women sexualize me just from coming in the building, and I'm tall, you know? And then I'm going to be exploited by the white men in a certain way. And then people see me as an authority figure for black and brown kids if I'm in a school, like a K-12. And then if I'm teaching in higher education, just to say, hey, we got a black male doctor, is saying a lot, because only 0.8% of black males is doctors. You know, that's across the field. So it's hard. It's hard.
So back to like the people like Mark Zuckerberg, Steve Jobs. I think one thing people get messed up, right? There's this like this stereotype. Drop out of college, your first semester, you start a $1 million company.
Yeah.
These people didn't drop out of college until they were making like companies like making millions of dollars, right?
Yeah.
So like, you know, it's not like they dropped out first semester. Like, they stay in college for like sophomore, junior year before they dropped it, right? And people, there's a stereotype, you know, start a company, drop out, make $1 million, right? But these people like stayed in college for a while.
Yeah, but look what college they went to. They ain't go to no just they ain't go no backwood college.
And not only that, you know, like people like, you know, like Jeff Bezos, Bootstrap. Well, if his daddy gave him a $300,000 loan free, interest free loan, bootstrapping, yeah. If like Bill Gates, I mean, if his I don't have the story right, but his mother either knew someone on the IBM board, or was it like some, I think if I get it right, she worked for a nonprofit and someone else on the nonprofit board was the IBM board. That's obviously connected, right? Like you said, like, actually, you know, I hate the term privilege, to be honest with you, but it's privilege, right? Like, you have to connect it. But is that privilege, or is it like networking, is connections, right?
All of it.
Yeah.
And some people take privilege as a bad thing. Mm-hmm. Like, I would like to be privileged. You know what I'm saying? Like, not in the ways that I already said, but like, everybody would like that. However, it's how you utilize your privilege.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? What are we doing to it to stop and disrupt some of the things that have been impacting us, right? And my privilege, right when the instant when I walk into the classroom, this is the first day, I tell the people what my privilege is. And I also say how I
can. You tell me your privilege is I'm from Texas.
Oh, you look, Texas pride all day. But I tell them, like, you know, you might be impacted by a male standing in front of you and telling you what to do. And some folks be like, it's always been males who have harmed me. So I already know that there's going to be some type of harm for somebody in this room. And like, how do I take that harm and change it into something that we can collaboratively make for you to be successful in this classroom? Because I can't undo what somebody else done. But however, I can help you feel safe. And whatever that safety looks like, I want to make sure that we're tapping into that so that we can reach our goal.
So in your sister class, like, let's suppose you have 20 people in class. Like, how do you make sure, like, you reach, like, each person has, like, a different background, different everything, right?
Uh-huh.
Different, like, trauma, different things. Like, how do you, like, make sure you, like,
reach everybody? Person?
Yeah, that has to be hard to fucking do, right? It's like,
so I come in with different methods. You know what I'm saying? Like, you like peanut butter and jelly sandwiches?
Yeah.
How you make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? Tell me. Just,
yeah, so piece of bread.
What type of bread?
White bread.
White bread?
Okay. I am white, you know?
Yeah, white bread. Okay.
I put the peanut butter on it.
Okay.
Then I put the jelly on the same bread.
Jelly on the same bread.
Then I put the other bread on top of it.
Wow. Okay, so you don't even mix it like that. You just, okay.
Yeah, white bread, peanut butter, jelly, and put the other piece of bread on it.
Same knife, spoon?
Same knife, yeah.
Okay.
Actually, same fork. I use a fork.
Okay. No toasting, no nothing, right?
No.
All right.
As a matter of fact, didn't ever cross my mind to toast it.
Listen.
I didn't try that out.
I can ask, if we had a room of 20 kids, I bet all 20 kids have something different. Some people going to cut the sides. Some people going to cut it in the middle. Some people going to use a fork. Some people not. Some people going to put butter on it. So
some people take the crust off.
I come in and I have five different methods of how I'm going to present to the class. And I say, hey, if you are not able to see well, but you are auditory person, I actually have a video ready for you. If you're a person who's hands-on, I'm a lecture for like 20 minutes, then next 10 minutes, got something to do. Lecture for 20 minutes, another 10 minutes, we got something to do. If you're a visual person, with my lectures, you'll have a PowerPoint. And so on. I just try to make sure that I'm tapping in and hitting all levels of communication for folks to be successful in my class.
I have to ask this question. It's a fucked up question, right?
Go ahead.
You ever ask, is there anyone here not smart enough to be in this class?
No. I mean, if you came into
you ever ask somebody, do you think you're not smart enough to be here? Like, do you like the skills?
I think a lot of people have imposter syndrome.
Yeah.
And that's just due to white supremacy practices. Like, you're not good enough to be here. But when you come in my class, we're all on the same level field. Like, I'm teaching you how to be a doctor. I'm teaching you how to think in certain ways that you have never thought before. And also, sometimes I'm not grading their papers. Their peers are helping them grade their papers. Okay. So nobody really fails my class. I don't think I ever had somebody fail my class unless you just didn't do the work. And I'm like, not hard. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're tapping in. And
so you're taking like bachelor level classes, master level classes?
Bachelor's and master's. You know, I teach a master course at the University of Puget Sound. I teach bachelor courses at the University of Washington and Pierce College and at Oregon Institutional Technology.
What do you enjoy about teaching?
Just learning new stuff. Like, as I'm teaching students about history, about politics, about structures of laws, race, power, and privilege, I'm learning from them what's new coming out of the community. And because of that, like, it's great to hear their voices and be able to collectively create things that's going to change our system.
So is this such a thing? I mean, recently white privilege is a big thing, right? Is this such a thing as black privilege or Hispanic privilege or Asian American privilege?
I think we all have a certain privilege inside our community. It doesn't look like white privilege across, you know, internationally. But yeah, we have certain privilege. We have colorism in our community. We have privilege when it comes to who has certain access. You know, when you look at a first generation African-American born individual, and then an African who have migrated here, some of those Africans who have migrated here don't have privilege, and then others do, depending on what their connections was to the States and what families have done here. And then also, like, not only just that, sometimes the folks who didn't have no privilege and have rose up and did great things for the community here and for this country, sometimes they get corrupted. And on the flip side of that, African-American males and women have done the same thing with the same trajectory just on the flip side, and have gained privilege and done something different with it. So it just depends. Sometimes the privilege can be positive. Sometimes the privilege can be negative. That's why they say the term all kinfolk ain't skinfolk. You know? I mean, all skinfolk ain't kinfolk. Yeah, so, yeah.
So here's one for you. Like, obviously, you're not an economic person, but I might be making this up. But I remember reading somewhere, like, if you had, like, the Asian American community, Hispanic community, or any community, right, like, that kind of close-knit, right? Like, if you spend a dollar, that dollar gets passed around like 13 times a community, where the African community, black community, like, they may pass 2 or 3 times.
Well, so the thing about that is a lot of people don't tap into the axiology of our demographics. So let me tell y'all what the axiology is. Axiology is what the highest value is to that demographic or to that characteristic of a person. So with African-American people, it's about person to person. It's a relationship. So we're passing around money and we're not equitably doing that, then you're breaking the relationship. With Native American folks, it's about person to spirit and person to land. So if we're not connecting with our spirit and the spirit's not connecting us back to you, we're not going to pass that money back around like that. Or if it's not nurturing into the land. Well, white folks, it's a number. You giving me the right number, we're good. We're not getting the right number, there's no relationship in it. And that's with everything across the board. Look at it from, you used to watch, like, the Trojans. You know, the Roman Empire.
Yeah, right. I'm a big Roman.
So gladiator, I'm a big Roman. Right? Okay. Yeah. So what happens when a gladiator gets, like, injured?
He's fucked.
And then we get what? Another gladiator.
Yeah. They're expendable.
A number. You're not as big as the program. The program is you need to be fighting as a warrior.
Yeah, there's plenty of slaves or gladiators. We don't call it.
So think about it. And I'm just going to keep driving this theory out for you, okay? So we went from the Roman Empire. Now we're going to go to prison. When a prisoner dies, what happened? We replace it with another prisoner. All right. So when a kid gets expelled from school, we replace that seat with somebody else. It's the same thing. It just trickles down in so many different motions. So I get folks to understand how society works and the order of society. I'm like, we're still doing things way back in BC and all of that. Like, it hasn't changed.
It's off subject. Isn't crazy how the Roman Empire still impacts us, right?
Mm-hmm.
Cause, like, y'all don't even know this, right? You know why our highways, like, the roads are like, so you have a single lane road, right? You know, right? That's the size it is.
Mm-mm.
Way back in the day, the Roman Empire started building roads. They built the roads based on the size of the horse's ass and the chariot.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Okay.
This day, yeah.
Okay, that's interesting. Thing, right? Yeah, that's interesting. That's interesting. No, I didn't know that.
So here's one for you. let's suppose there's a 47-year-old white person out there, black, I mean, white, female, male, whatever, right? They're pretty successful, have a business, make what's like $20 million a year. Why should they care about race equity or diversity or anything like that?
I mean, race equity is a part of every social configuration of our lives. I don't think you can get past it because it deals with our communication. It deals with how we view you as a person, how we understand your personable skills and skills for the job, and also just application-wise. Like, I can look at an application right now, and instantly if I see Harvard, I'm like, oh, they're cold, they're good, oh my gosh. But if I saw Green River College next to it, I'm like, they went to a community college. What would they know better than Harvard, right? But to be honest with you, it just really depends on, like, you having an understanding of we need to look at this as the individual and not just the institution. And that deals with race equity. Like, who had access to what? Like, did this person who got to Harvard, was this built off their merit of, like, really working hard and they got that degree?
Or their legacy.
Or their legacy.
Or did, like, their granddaddy give a $20 million building or something, right?
Right. And just instantly, when you said that, right, we automatically had a picture in our head that this probably might be a white person. So with race equity, we don't even have that picture. We're just going through all the different characteristics of whom this person could be. And then instantly, sometimes we automatically think it's a male. right when we have an institution in our head, we're like, that's a male.
Yeah. Here's one for you. I just came to my mind, right? So a lot of times people will say, I don't see color. I don't see a black person, I see a white person. And people will say, like, no, I'm a feeling the color of race, right? This is how I am, right? What's taking this? Like, should really be a colorblind society? Or if you were like, okay, you're from Italy, you're from Ukraine, you're from Mexico. Like, I see, like, your, like, quote unquote struggles, your other shit you had to go through, right?
Yeah, I mean, yes. You know, that's the critique of liberalism. We can't say we don't see color because that takes away this person's upbringing, this person's culture, this person's ethnicity. And within that lies their tradition and whom they are, right? So we can't erase that. And then secondly, I don't want to make the assumption that they actually had a struggle. Maybe they never had a struggle and they just good from whatever they're from. But we need to take in those traditions and say, hey, what do you have new and diverse to bring? To say you don't see color and you're just going to treat everybody the same, it's like saying you don't care to know about a person and their true identity.
Because you never know what someone's been through, you know, their background. Like, so recently on TikTok, this black lady did a TikTok, a post on TikTok, and she said, why do so many white people adopt black babies, right? Who curse for me, right? And she's like, blast, like, all these black people who adopt, like, white people came back on, like, you know, had a great life, whatever, you know. And one guy, like, he actually went viral, right? His answer was, so she said, why do so many white people adopt black babies, right? This white guy came back. He's like, redneck motherfucker. Like, this. He's like, why do so many black babies need to be adopted, right? It's like, this is a pretty cool conversation, right? Mm-hmm. It's like how interesting that is, right? How, like, my thing is, like, it doesn't matter who raised you, right? As long as you raise you with love and, like, mentorship and stuff, right?
Right.
I think two people can. And of course, there's a thing, like, you know, what do you, like, if you're, like, you're from Italy, would it be preferential to be raised by Italian people? Maybe so, right? But would you rather be raised by Italian people to fucking abuse the fuck out of you? Or, like, fucking, somebody from Nigeria, right? I think it's like...
Here's the thing. Anytime we are doing something, we have to be mindful of the historical truths that has come about of what we're doing. So for a white person adopting a black kid, sometimes that comes out of saviorism of what we felt like we needed to do with Africa and certain communities in the United States, that all these black kids just need somebody to come in and support them and help them. And you have to do it this way. And it's like, No, have you ever asked the kid like what do they need support with or anything like that? And then like what is the histories of why it has to be a white parent? You know what I'm saying? Like, is there not other families that would have took in this kid? And let's talk about the system in a whole even then.
But what if
Like,
there's not other people taking him in though? What if the only like, or what if there's only Hispanic people who take a black kid in?
it could be, I mean, I would still say the same thing. Like, I think we need to look at the system in a whole. Why is this happening? How are we getting all these kids who need to be adopted? You know, what's happening in our community where we're having our families come up in abusive and poverty times and areas? Like, it's a system. Most of the things that's happening in this country, 90% of the system.
So that's a good question for you. Like way back in the day, Lyndon B. Johnson started like the welfare state, right? Like some people say the US government purposely replaced the black father with the government. You think it's a legitimate claim or think this is like fucking made up shit?
No, I mean, a lot of our African American men were prospering. And in order for the order, and I'm keep going back to keep the order and establish order in the United States, we need to take out what we feel that we have a fear in. We have a fear of African American men making impact and doing great things in this country and devaluing a white American man. So we have to make stricter laws that will cause them to go into jail. We have to make stricter laws that if you are disciplining your kid in a way that we don't see fit, that we can take your kid away. We have to make stricter laws that if you do have a felony, you can't get fair housing, right? Or vote to make even an impact. So there's like so many different ways that these laws have like impacted us as a society, and we're not tapping into that and saying, hey, how can we get more change agents in that? And I'll go a little further just for a quick second. You've been in HR for how long?
25, 30 years.
25, 30 years.
Pretty
So
long.
if I gave you like a list of 100 people in your company, not this company, but like companies that you worked for, how many people would you say in HR was black and brown? 100 people.
25%. That's probably too high.
25%. That's too high. Why do you think that? HR is the people who, you know, they screen your resume and say, oh, okay, this can push through.
Where HR does like very high, so with HR, like the very, very top, like chief human resource officers, there's a lot of white guys, right? Right below is a lot of white females. And then like right below there's a lot of like we'll say like, you know, other races and stuff. But yeah, there's like pretty much, man, I think off the top of my head, every like head of HR, like big company like Apple, Google, they're all white guys.
Yeah.
Either white guys or white females.
As a purpose behind that, you know, how can we continue to make oppressive educational system if we're having folks who come in and want to change it? If I have a body of 80% of black and brown, I'm not saying that they're all going to like each other or work good with each other or probably don't have white supremacy practices. But what I would say is, creatively, something's different is going to change. Some type of policy will change. And we don't want those policies to change.
So to me, this is the craziest thing, right? I'm getting the facts messed up, right? Like I always do. But a few years ago, there was like a DEI person. This person, the white guy, charged DEI or Apple, right? And the DEI stats actually were fucking down, right? He got hired at Google and got a raise, right? So I'm thinking, like, how the fuck you hire someone at a big ass company and the fucking DEI stats actually went down? And hiring for more money, right? That fucked me up.
I
And
really can't.
I might have the companies wrong, but it's like big time tech. It's like it was like Apple, Google, or Salesforce, or some, yeah.
I mean, so we do some things for interest conversions. And what we mean by that is we will push policies, practices only if it benefit white people. So you remember the time Gucci had put out that it was an ad, and it was a bad ad. I don't think it had anything to do with blackface, but I think it was something about like an animal, and it was derogatory to, you know, the black community, right? So the instant thing that they did was they hired a black woman to be the chief executive officer of diversity for Gucci. And it's all supposed to be like, oh, we back to kick it with Gucci and get stuff with Gucci. That was like an interest conversions.
I'll get blasted for this too. I just think so many big companies like hire diversity people just like it's a hot thing to do, right?
That's not, you don't get blasted for that. Like, that is an interest conversion thing. Like,
And I remember back when the George Floyd stuff came out, right? That's a bad thing. There was so many, especially like tech, like a lot of VC companies, they would put these statements, we support blah, blah, blah. But like you do research, all white VCs never invested a black company. It's like, that's performative, right?
Like, why wouldn't I, as a oppressive white person, why wouldn't I be performative if I know people are getting canceled and getting their money taken away? I gotta play the part. But behind closed doors, I don't have to show it because you're not gonna look in, the average American's
Oh,
not gonna
no.
look into that.
They're gonna say, you know, blah, blah, company, we support XYZ. Matter of fact, this is a perfect example, right? So in the vendor community, right, all the time, blank corporation, we're gonna hire 20,000 vendors in 5 years. But they never come back in 5 years to say, we hired 20,000 veterans or we only hired tired. Only company they did is I give Starbucks credit, right? One time they said we're gonna hire 20,000 veterans in 4 years. 4 years later they say they actually came out and said we failed at our goal. We only hired 5,000, right? Which I gave him credit for, right? He was honest, right? But most companies, they say what they're gonna do, but they don't do it. It's like, that's a good publicity, right?
I'll go further. And when COVID hit, the NBA was playing in a bubble. And then we had a tragic death that happened in Milwaukee where another African American man was killed by a police officer. And they stopped the play. Milwaukee Bucks stopped playing. They said they wasn't going to play that night.
I remember that. I remember that
And
night.
a lot of people did. Kyrie Irving was one of the main advocates to say, hey, we don't need this league. We got millions of dollars. We can go make our own league. Forget them. All they want us to do is play. Because they had a big push to have these NBA players play because this is what America wanted to see. Donald Trump is talking about he wants to see sports played again. He doesn't care how it looks. He wants to see sports play. And what the NBA said was, okay, what is your cause? What's the issue? And they're like, what do you mean with the issue? Y'all have been seeing everything that's been going on. So they're like, tell us how we can do this, how we can work together and get you all back on the court. Because the moment, every time that we miss a game or we cancel a game, it's millions of dollars that we're missing, right? So the NBA players are like, well, you have to support some of our initiatives, the Black Lives Matter, and so on, right? So that year, you start seeing them with the Black Lives Matter shirts. You had LeBron with it on and all of those different things. Tell me where you see those things now.
Crickets.
Performative. That was the interest conversions. I know that if I say that I can commit 500 million or 100 million to an initiative that you NBA players union want to put your money to for a cause, that you'll get back out there and play. But the moment that the season is over with, we'll probably continue it for like another year or two. But the exposure of us showing that we're doing this and we're going out in the communities and we're hand in hand with you supporting that, that's gone. We don't even talk about that no more. Right now, we're talking about the new teams that's going to the NBA and not talking about, hey, what other cause are we supporting that are impacting our community? Have we talked about gun violence? Have we talked about the physical abuse that's been happening to women? Like, no.
So that's one of my criticisms. Like, you're like, one of my criticisms, like, you have this protest, right? Their protest maybe 6 months, this dies down, right? It's like there's always a protest on something, right? They protest 3 or 4 months and it's replaced, right? It's like, it has to be, like, to me, it has to be more of a long term plan, right? Whatever you're protesting against, like, has to be a long term plan. You just can't protest 3 or 4 months in the streets and like crickets, right?
Yeah, I mean, so that's very hard. I mean, back in the day when the civil rights, when they were doing it, their back was against the wall. They had no choice. It was either you change this or we got to fight. We cannot be enslaved people when we already had laws that said we're not this no more. So we're marching. We're boycotting. We're doing all of that. I think now that the laws have changed again and they're strict to where folks are losing jobs and they have to battle with, how do I feed my kids? Do I still go for this cause that is true to me, or do I have to assimilate and compromise? And some of these companies know, like, you can't do this all day. Or if they see you out there doing it, they'd be like, well, did you take a sick day? Did you take a vacation? Oh, you're out of sick days and vacation. Oh, you lost that. Ooh, this is a bad representation of our company that you went out here and did this. So we got to let you go. It's hard. So now we have to find new ways to fight this issue.
So do you think when people protest, do you think they really protest and be protest, or are they being performed themselves, right? For example, in Seattle all the time, you see like people protesting, they block I-5, they block our roads. Do you think they really like protesting something, or like they just want to bring attention to themselves?
I'm going to say some people protest and protest, others definitely performative. Like, I'm like, it's crazy how, you know, we have the MLK march all the time. And if when you see the MLK march, it's a lot of white folks, black folks, you know, so on. More white than anything. Because, I mean, we stay in Seattle, right?
It's white.
Yeah, Seattle, yeah, yeah. Right? So you're going to see that, right? But when there comes an issue, where are they at when we have certain things that's happening in our black and brown community? Like, they stop it, or they do it in moments to where it looks good for them. Like, I don't see that same MLK movement happening when BLM is going on. And when BLM is going on, you're rioting. You're like, you're tearing down companies that had nothing to do with it. You know what I'm saying? And some companies that's actually supporting have the signs like, yo, we're supporting Black Lives, like, and we've been doing this. Like, this ain't nothing new. And then you're going in there and stealing, or and it's hurting our community. And like, we don't do that. Like, we didn't ride in many different times. We ride when we needed to, but this wasn't a moment that we needed to. So when we're doing peaceful marches and we have folks who are not of that movement tearing down stuff, that's moments. Because now you have other people like, oh, shoot, we made that big and let's do it again because we have the opportunity to do it and we can, like, benefit off of this. Like, nah.
I remember one time, like, a few years ago, right, back when they were doing all the protests in Seattle, it's like the COVID, George Floyd, whatever, stuff going on. And so I used to work out of the rework at the soccer union, right? So I would catch the bus from soccer union back to the house, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this one time, like, I make sure I plan it right, because I had to be home for something, right? It was a birthday, or something really important I want to be there. Like, very important to me, right? I'd be home at a certain time, right? So I caught the bus an hour early, whatever, to make sure there's time. And so the bus goes to West, like the Westlake area, right?
Mm-hmm.
Had a protest, right? No traffic going through. It's like, I was like for 3 hours. I went on the fucking phone and researched, what is this protest about? I remember what it was. I didn't give a fuck what it was about. I donated to the cause they were protesting against.
Wow.
Because I was so pissed, right?
Mm-hmm.
But like, so I think sometimes the shit backfires, right?
Yeah. You know, we're gonna be protesting a lot. I think
and I believe, like, if you're it's all right to protest, like, protest, right? Like, this is your God-given right. Maybe not God-given right, but America right, right? But, like, is protest really the best way to do it, right? Is a better way, like all these protests? Are you voting? You know, like, are you calling congressmen? Like,
it depends. I mean, I would say there's no one size fits all when we're talking about disrupting and dismantling injustice. We must take all avenues. I think protesting is the one that gets the most social media presence. But we
doesn't really push the cause forward, though.
But we also don't like promote when we have cities that are changing policies. They don't want to put that out. Like, it's happening. Like, it's happening in ways in that we don't want to change the narrative of what America is. I mean,
that's a good
is.
Point. Like, how many people actually go to city council meetings? How many people actually go, like, super, like, schools, like, what's it called? School district meetings, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, how many people, like, actually go and, like, and tell their stories, right?
But here's the thing about that. When they tell their stories, how much time they get?
2 seconds. But
so what's the point?
But it, about,
what's the point?
It's like this. If you stand in front of a microphone, who's going to take it from you?
Who's going to take it from you?
Yeah.
Nobody's going to take it from you unless they say, hey, you went over your time. So now you have security.
I don't recognize your fucking time. If you put your hands on me, I'll put my hands on you.
See, that's a privilege statement, though, because most people will be like, man, I didn't see what happened to when they're like, hey, you went over time. We already know who your kid is. So we ain't never letting you back in here. So you ain't going to be able to talk.
But if you can talk for one time.
And they don't have to take it. They don't have to take nothing we say. They just be like, oh, performative. Oh, we listen to the community. You did good.
That's when you go like this. Videotape your shit. Post on social media.
Yeah, social media has been a big influence and help for us, right? But who runs the algorithm? Everything is controlled.
Okay, let me ask you this. So there's a different level of smart, right?
Yeah.
Science smart, physics smart. How smart do you think you are?
Me?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I think I'm very smart.
Very smart.
It depends on what we're talking about. I think in my field, I'm very smart.
Very smart.
Very smart. But anything outside, I have growth moments. I'm like, teach me something.
What's something you want to learn that you don't know yet?
Ooh, that's a good one. I actually want to learn how to be a mechanic. Like, you know how much time...
If I would have fucking put a list of 100 things that I thought you want to learn, that'd be like 200.
Yo, think about it, though. Think about this.
You know,
how often do people's cars break down?
The car is like such a different level, right? It's like
fucking... We're going to electric, but you got to learn now how to like work an electric car. Like, none of us are electricians. So like, I would want to learn like how to fix on something. If I'm in a desert going down I-5 to go to LA and my car just stops, I'll get my family back on the road.
I'm calling them fucking USAA.
Man, what if they can't? We can't reach them.
Motherfucker, you better refund my money I pay every goddamn month.
Mm-mm. You stuck out there in the desert. What you doing? Phone don't work. You got to figure out what's going wrong with this car to get this car back on the road.
Guess I'm walking.
That's what I'm saying. You're walking along. You probably get caught by a coyote. All right. We're on I-5. We're in that desert part in California. And it's probably another 50 miles to get to a gas station. That's a long time.
Yeah. I'm like, I don't know. That's a tough one.
I'm just saying. I think that's and then you think about it. It's a machine.
Yeah.
You start learning working parts that you never seen before. And then you start be like, oh, okay, this can work in other areas in my life. What you thought I wanted to learn?
Oh, man. I would say AI. How can AI improve education?
Man. I actually don't think AI improves education. I'm probably going to be the first person to say that. I think AI makes us lazy. I think we don't put in the much work ourselves to do it. I mean, AI is a good resource for giving us.
I'm gonna push back.
Go ahead.
So back in the day, like teachers would say, You gotta learn. You gotta learn. You gotta learn math. Now you have a calculator in your pocket all the time, but now we do. I think in the future you're gonna have some kind of AI-enabled device in your system. You'll be able to like say, AI, blase, blase, blase.
I think you should utilize AI in ways of yes. If you need a quick answer, AI is a great tool and resource for us. Like Action Siri.
You know, that's, people like fucking coding like fucking all like companies with AI, right?
Yeah.
It's fucking insane.
I believe so. And if it's to do that, yes. But when we're talking about education, you got to remember, we're asking you to write a paper and you to give us your thoughts. And if you're giving me AI, I can't say that you're going to be able to develop a skill because AI is doing a skill for you. So why do I need you? And then you're going to complain AI is taking our jobs. So as long as we are developing the skill and developing our brains and in ways, we wouldn't need a robot to do anything for us.
That's when people realize AI is taking all the fucking jobs.
AI is.
Like, I see AI robots fucking cleaning toilets. I see AI robots fucking picking fruit.
AI is
doing fucking like doing to develop a code. I mean,
it's free labor. It's free labor because AIs don't have, and then you're going to start hearing people say AI lives matter. But AIs don't have human capabilities to have feelings like that. So they're controlled, right? But in the same sense, what happens when AI actually does take over everything? What are you useful for?
I mean, what's that scene from Space Odyssey 2001? No hell. I can't close the door. Something like that, right?
There was a, I got to research this. Cause it was a Netflix movie that everybody was watching.
Not a doctor do research.
Yeah, I got to. It was an AI movie that everybody, it was not AI movie. It was a movie on Netflix that everybody watched, and it was about like the world shutting down. Like China was like, what is it? What is this guy name? China was okay. Here's the guy. China was threatening the United States, and they shut off all our internet. And when they shut off all our internet and stuff, the Teslas was like running into each other and all of these different things. And I'm like, this is control. So when the world is controlled, what is used for humans? We've been seeing this so often in different like movies of like how this stuff gonna play out.
I mean, they say singularity is gonna happen like 2033, 2034.
So what are we going to do? What are we going to do? I want to say what the Netflix movie is.
I mean, Skynet's coming, right?
Leave the world behind. Did you see that? It was a cyber attack that knocked out all the devices and stuff. And you couldn't do anything. So the main thing that happened in there that was the key was, it was a guy, white American man who had like, you know, a lot of resources. And it was a guy who was with him who was another white. It was a black individual who went to the guy who had all the resources. And he brought a white individual with him because his son was sick. And he's like, hey, I just need you to help my son. Right. And he really didn't want to help the son. He was like, man, can't do nothing for you, bro. You got to go back home. He's like, come on, bro. Like, have some decency. Right. And the biggest key was that he was like, we're here together. This is about us. If we don't help us, we're doomed. And he's basically also talking about like race and racism. Like all of that stuff don't matter when we have this type of attack on us. That stuff should be going out the window. But now that folks are like utilizing AI so much, like TikTok, I don't think we're going to have any choice but to like assimilate to it. But I'm like, if you assimilate to it, you're not going to have a job too often. Like we can have an AI do this podcast. Then what happens?
Yeah. That's true.
We don't have a Jason HR no more.
So with AI taking jobs, supposedly, what's your take on universal basic income? Universal basic income, you know what that is? So basically, universal basic income, income is like they pay everyone a salary for the basic stay at home, right? All the jobs are gone and they pay you like a certain amount of money to be comfortable, right?
That's so subjective. Like a certain amount, do we all get the pick or this is like a scale?
That I don't know. They haven't figured that right.
Okay.
So universal basic income is like, you know, like for example, like suppose like truck drivers, right? There's 250,000 truck drivers in the United States. Okay. Hopefully, right? Autonomous trucks are coming, right? So truck drivers don't have a job anymore. So a truck driver would say, I mean, if they own their own company, they make like maybe $20,000 a year. They drive maybe $100,000 a year. So basically, give every truck driver $150,000 a year, universal basic income, right? That's a good point, right? So do you give like everyone the same salary, like $300,000 a year? Or do you give like, okay, you used to clean fucking toilets at $10 an hour. Here's $10 an hour to have to do it, right?
Well, since AI will be taking over, what would this money be used for us to buy these AI machines?
It's like to pay your salary. It's basically pay you not to work.
But what would we be doing? Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, there's...
You would have no job.
So we'll just... Yeah, right. We have no job, right?
It's to give you money to pay for rent, basic necessities, maybe do a hobby.
Most of the hobbies going to be AI. So I'm like, it would be smart if they said, we're paying you money enough to buy AI machines to do whatever you need to make money.
Yeah. Yeah. Research UBI. It's a lot of fucking controversy about it, right?
Yeah. And I'm like, that ain't going to work in a capitalist society. People, you're going to have greed. They're going to be like, he got more money than me.
Yeah.
Like, I forgot what the movie was, but it was almost like a Matrix thing. I think you know what the movie is, but they were in this bubble and a guy controlled the bubble and all of them was making the same type of money until this woman figured out they were in a bubble and like they really couldn't die like that. And she had to escape the bubble. And I'm like, I feel like sometimes we're living in that to where we, not in the sense of a bubble, but like we're living in a time where so much things is controlled and we're influenced by it that it's shaping who our identity is and our purpose. Like we can't fall away from the purpose. You have a successful podcast because you deem this as something that you enjoy and you want to bring people in here to talk about political things, you know, some funny stuff. And like I said, I think AI can't do that. So if you decided to be like, I'm not going to do this no more. I'm going to tell AI where I want you to ask the folks and stuff like that and chill and lay back. But what if people start falling in love with them? Then what? It's like, oh, shit. I don't have anything. Like, I say use AI just for...
It's a tool. That's all it is, a tool.
Yeah, for some things that will take a while to develop, right? And once it's developed, then you as the individual critique or edit what you want to be in your liking. Because the AI can't make it to super to your liking. There's some stuff you're going to critique anyway, like websites or whatever. And then, hey, go with that and just do your thing.
So how do we fix this or does it need to be fixed, right? So example, I use Dallas, Texas, right? Highland Park, multi-million dollar homes. Property taxes is high, so the schools are like, you know, like off the chain, right? And plus, you know, if they say Highland Park High School says we need money for whatever, we want to go to like Washington D.C., it's like paid by the parents, right? Dallas Carter High School, you know, like economically disadvantaged, like fucking they can't afford shit. Highland Park probably have fucking the latest Apple Mac computers. Dallas Carter probably is fucking like IBM computers in 1997, right? I know I'm a capitalist. I'm not a socialist. Like, how do you like? Has to be a way to fix that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Has to be a way like to make it more fair. Is like
a levy.
A levy? Okay. What kind of levy?
So, how do we? Sorry. How do we talk about economic resources that need to be poured into certain communities in the school district, and not just the school district, but the state, and disperse the money evenly, even amongst our affluent communities like Highland Park? But, and this is what the levy is supposed to do, but oftentimes we have these levies pouring into these more affluent areas because some of the folks who are councilmen, some of the folks who have political influence, kind of dictates where this money goes. So if I went to Highland Park and I don't know too much about Carter, even though you tell me about it, I'm like, oh, I'll give you a few hundred thousands, maybe a million, and do something with it. And then back here, we're going to put more in because they're going to produce more people like me. So I think there's always going to be a greed until we dismantle how we operate and do things. And it starts with the course of like how we separate the money. And if you are a person who, perfect example, my bad. Now just hit me. Look at the WNBA. So the WNBA is a national sport where a lot of our elite women basketball players go into when they get drafted to. Similar to our NBA, National Basketball Association. National Basketball Association brings in billions of dollars. They have billions of dollars contract for TV deals, jerseys, player likenesses, and so on. However, our WNBA players are not getting paid as much, don't even have long seasons, and some of the players that they draft outside of the second round don't even make the team. So some in the first round don't even make the team. You know what I'm saying? It's not that many spots. So what has to happen is the NBA has to come back to the field and say, well, how can we create an expansion to where we're building more teams, we're marketing more teams, and we're also pouring into making the sport just as enjoyable that it is in the NBA so that we can pick up more money over here? Because I can give the same amount of money to Highland Park and Carter, but if Carter still has things that's economically impacting them around the community, doesn't matter how much money I give them, there's still going to be that other side to it. But if Highland Park is getting the same amount of money and their communities are still growing and it's looking good, they're going to be able to produce more money. So this is why things need to change in the WNBA in order for them to get uplifted and amplify their marketable skills and get this expansion. But without the expansion, WNBA, it doesn't matter how great we have more Caitlin's and
Angel Reese.
Yeah, Angel Reese.
And the lady from South Carolina.
Yeah. So, and like, it's not going to make a.
The lady from Stanford.
It's not going to make a difference. Like, we all had those players in the WNBA already. We already had Cynthia Coopers. We already had Lisa Leslie's and Candace Parker's, so on. Those generational players, but the money never changed. And then Diana Taurasi is probably like the most gifted out of everybody, and the money still haven't changed. Like, we have given them 100 or 200,000 more. Cool. That's great. But the structure of the WNBA and how we disperse that money is still the same. Like, you can share 500-600 million and say, hey, we're going to get these ladies some actual private jets, okay? And then once we buy all of these private jets, now we got airplanes for the rest of the time being in the WNBA. They just have to create more money from other likeliness to, like, pay for those jets' fuel and maintenance on that. If not, then the NBA will cover that. And then so on. Like, it's just... we don't do enough of talking about where we have gaps at to make those changes.
So do you know who Bill Burr is? Mm-mm. He's a white comedian, right? Peter Parker comedian, right? Married a black lady, right? He just get on at WNBA one time, right? He's got kind of curve, right? He's like, don't give me this bullshit of WNBA failing. Who failed him? You woman. Like, none of you women go to the WNBA games, right? Like, you support men sports more than the WNBA, right?
So that's true and not true. Like, I would say his truth is that you're right. A lot of women don't support women's basketball, but WNBA basketball. However, they're supporting college. Why? They're getting more exposure. They're on TV more. We're not putting as much WNBA games on TV. We're also not making WNBA games cool to advertise. We don't even have them in like the NBA games.
I mean, for example, if you go to ESPN on the website, right, there's a tab you click on. Mm-hmm. It's all this, like, all the sports, right? If you click on it, it's like WNBA is like number 37 sport that comes on, right? Like ice hockey, college basketball, all this is above WNBA, right?
Everything is above WNBA. And WNBA has the shortest season. They play for like 3 months.
That's what's so crazy. Like, there's like 12 teams. They play 40 games. And most of the players go overseas to play. Most NWA players make money overseas.
Yeah, they got longer seasons.
Yeah.
And we know in our European countries that they damn near play year round. So this is why it's hard sometimes to buy those players out of their contracts, because the Euro team's like, for what? Why would you go over there?
Real estate, me and my family stayed in so career for 3 years, right? Mm-hmm. So let me backtrack. Well, I was in Italy, I had a soldier that worked for me, Reggie Franklin, right? Mm-hmm. E4. His wife was a Todd McGuinness record, right? She's actually Hall of Fame WNBA right now, right? So we went to Italy, we moved to Korea for 3 years. She played every year in Korea, right? She played 6 months in Korea, all the games, right? Mm-hmm. All the players on all the Korean teams, like 95% were US WNBA players, right? Maybe a couple of Koreans, right? Mm-hmm. They made big money over there, right? Actually, Todd told me they made way more money overseas than in the WNBA. And she said it wasn't close. She's like, wasn't for this, I couldn't live my lifestyle.
Right. I remember Becky Hammon, when she first came in the league, she was making $68,000 a year. Like, where can you go making $68,000 a year in some places?
I'm going to call it be a fucking account.
Right. But you got to think about that. $68,000, you got to take taxes out of that.
I mean, you got to really love basketball.
Really, really love basketball. But not only that, like, you got agents, you got to pay them, trainers, keep your skills up to make the
family
team.
Family paying for money. You're a WNBA player.
Family making money. You got to get you a car, right? So, like, overseas, they're taking care of most of your expenses and giving you a salary.
Yeah.
We're not doing that over here.
Unless you're playing for a wrestler, they put you fucking jail.
But we're so behind on different things in sports outside of, like, American sports. Like, the NBA players will always be paid well. Football players be paid well. Baseball would definitely be paid well.
Oh, my God. Like,
guaranteed contract.
If I tell anyone, like, someone's, like, equal to challenge, like, all sports, go fucking baseball. You can play until you die, make millions of dollars a year, hit a ball, whatever. No, I'm wrong. I'm pretty sure it's fucking, like, tiresome to play baseball every fucking day, right?
But it's a tough sport to like do. Like, I cannot hit a baseball. Doesn't matter what speed.
Remember they did an episode with Deion Sanders. That was the hardest part. Baseball. Like, mm-hmm. That ball do some things.
Yeah, you got people throwing it in curves. It's going up and down. About,
if you hit 3 out of 10, you're fucking a Hall of Famer.
Look.
So basically, you're failing 7 times, you're fucking Hall of Famer.
And then you have to, like, make sure you're timing this. And then that ball comes off. You don't want the ball to hit you.
Talk about
like
hand-eye coordination.
It's too much. You know what I'm saying? Basketball, you ain't got to worry about that. That's where you can be a diva at. Football, like, you got to be tough. Yeah. You got to be really, really tough. And then there's another flip side to that. Like, you know, brain trauma.
Yeah.
And then boxing. Like, hard to be elite.
Yeah, think about boxing. People don't realize that boxing, MMA, like, it's not another fight. It's the fucking sparring. If you're sparring, like the hits, right?
For a long time. And then there's only a couple elite guys every year. And you're like,
there's only so many fucking Mike Tyson.
Right. And like, or Canelo. Like Canelo, I think, is gonna go down in history as probably one of the greatest. If not top five.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think people will be biased. And there's a lot, you know what, there's a lot of great ones.
You know what? That's the thing. I think anything like where's a boxing, hip hop, it's so fucking hard to get your top five, right? Mm-hmm. Like top five is like Sugar Ray Leonard. I'll go with Sugar Ray Leonard.
Sugar Ray Leonard.
Thomas Hearns.
Sugar Ray Leonard and Julius, Robinson.
Julio Cesar Chavez from Mexico.
He's great. I think Canelo kind of passed him.
It's hard to fucking take your top five or anything.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, but if you fought like 60 something times and you only lost twice, come on. That's a lot. It ain't even a lot of boxers that's going to go past 40.
No.
And so.
And so check this out. So I have to go to the bathroom right now.
Go ahead.
So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put the camera on you. I want you to talk about your Black Boy Hill stuff, right?
Oh, okay. I can do that.
And so that's your camera right there.
All right.
Let's go all in. Like, talk about what you want to.
Okay. All right. We're going to talk about Black Boy Hill. So Black Boy Hill started in January 2021. When I was going through a lot of complications coming out of COVID, there was a time where I tried to commit suicide. Being is because I had lost a lot of friends, family members, and I didn't know where to place my feelings at or how to talk about certain issues that was impacting me in ways that it just wasn't centering me back into my purpose. So I wanted to create a company that focuses on how do we heal Black men in a way to where we feel comfortable enough in the society to talk about our feelings without being judged or without folks telling us that we can't be so these emotional beings. And emotional beings, whichever way you feel like you want to be. So I created this company for African-American males in the K-12 school system because I think that's where it's building up. It's coming out of where we're taking on habits from our parents. We're taking on habits from their parents. We're taking on habits from our communities. We're taking on habits from our schooling systems. We're taking on habits from our friends. And sometimes when you have these mixed identities and these intersections, it can do something to you if you don't know how to navigate those things. So I created Black Boy Hill to provide the free access and service to building up your mental health capacity to talk about these issues and build up these awarenesses to where you can take these skills not only into your families, but into your communities to where you can solve life's problems a little better and cope a little bit better when we have challenges. As you could tell that we have a lot of issues and impacts that's happening amongst our African-American males. And some things are systems based and some things are things that's just been happening in our community for so long that we have been sheltering and hiding for so long that we don't know what to do anymore. And we have assimilated to practices that is beyond our culture and our ethnic background. To where we're harming each other and causing lateral violence amongst our other communities as well. So Black Boy Hill is something that I've been trying to get in the schools for a while to us focusing on if we can heal each other, if we can disrupt the school to prison pipeline. I think it starts there. If you know how to voice and you know who your resources is and your allies is and how the schooling system is kind of set up and meant to hyper-surveillance you and break you into and mold you into a way of assimilating to their practices, then you are able to identify like how to move and you're able to identify when these challenges are coming up and how to fix your brain in a complex way of shifting to creating impact and positive potentials in the classroom and outside of the classroom. This is my life journey. I've been doing this before I even created the company because a lot of things have just been impacting my community. And I just believe that this is just this is God's work and this life work. And everybody should jump on board and try to create programs either or create programs that will do just for your kids from Black and Brown communities. Yeah, I was talking for a minute.
That's so cool. How has being a father changed your perspective on life?
Oh, I think I'm a little more gentle. You know, I love sleeping with my son, you know, at night, like, you know, being able to hold him, being able to see him smile, being able to see Black boy joy means a lot to me, especially in a world of so much hate, anger, and greed. It's always good to see the innocence of children and how they just want to be sheltered in love. And I think, you know, we all still want that as, you know, adults. Like, how can I just be loved when I wake up in the morning? How can I have this joyous smile? You know, and I credit, you know, my baby mother for that, because she always like has this joyous smile, you know, it's filled with joy when it comes to our child. And she's just amazing, you know?
So as a dad, how do you make sure your kid like stays curious, stays fun loving, all that, like all that kid stuff that we lose as an adult?
First off, he wakes up to Gracie's Corner. If he doesn't have Gracie's Corner, he's getting mad. He's definitely getting mad. And just taking him to parks, you know, letting him see what joy looks like on his own, like have him walk and see what he likes to do, and just keeping up with whatever he's like getting engagement with that attaches to his smile. And as he grows older, you know, some things are going to change. He's probably not going to like the Gracie's Corner no more. You probably want to be a Spider-Man guy or a Batman guy or whatever. But I'm just going to just keep to like learn and lean on to him to like teach me like what he likes.
So this is one of my pet peeves, right? So I think there's a lot of groups out there. So I think diversity is a good thing, right? All the stats show if you have a diverse company, everything improves, right? But I think there's too many groups out there. They'll be like, and like, remember, there's nothing wrong. Like, if you're like pro-Black, pro-Hispanic, pro-veteran, pro-left-handed, red-headed female, that's a great thing, right? But I think too many of these groups are like, I'm pro-blank, I'm diverse. Like, are you really diverse? Are you like pro your demographic, right? I think people get it mixed up.
Yeah, I mean, I think you can be pro whatever your demographics is and have respects for opening up doors for others. Like, I'm pro-Black. I would love to see African-American males, African-American identified women, trans, non-binary, so on, be uplifted, and still see the struggles of others and say, how can I bring them along, right?
But I think so many people don't do that, though.
No, they don't. But, you know, sometimes I think it's due to like, because if I'm looking at my struggle and I'm in this struggle now, why am I going to pay attention to somebody else's, right?
Well, then how can you see it for diversity if you're for your own struggle, though?
Yeah. But we also must understand that there are certain demographics that need to be focused on more in order for us to understand what are the practices that's impacting us as a demographic. Like, our educational system is literally set up to withhold the Black male from getting an education. This is why we don't see them in colleges. We don't see them in high school spaces. And we also are testing in the third grade to see what their reading level is, to start making beds in prisons. And if this is happening, right, and we learn how to support these African-American males, then we also will learn the skills to support our Native Americans, our Latin Americans, our Asian Americans, and so on. But our African-American males are the furthest away from educational justice. Currently at this time, it was a time when our African-American women was the same. It was a time when our Latin males was the same. It's always been a time when our Native Americans are the same, but the difference is African Americans in no form have assimilated to white practices. There have been other demographics that has assimilated and has benefited from it. And when they stop assimilating, then they're pushed and they are treated like they were an African American. So there was a lady, it's crazy because I have this on YouTube in one of my classes. I think it's Jane Elliott. She did a speech. She says, if you would like to be treated like an African American, please stand up. She was like, oh, okay. So y'all didn't understand the question. If you would like to be treated like an African American, like I think she said, stand up or raise your hand, right? Nobody did it. She said, oh, so you know what they are treated like, so why aren't you doing anything about it? And it was just all like, so, yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. So there's a lot of demographics in the United States, right? Different culture, whatever. What's a cultural demographic, like, you know, what do you want to call it, you know, like, that you think is like, needs the most help getting ahead?
Outside of African Americans, I would say Latin and Chicano and Chicana people. I mean, those are two different demographics, and sometimes we loop them in together. Chicana people have been here. I'm not gonna say they believed. They've been here in the United States for a long time. And, you know, they get treated like they're second class citizens. Our Latinx community, you know, I can only speak for certain areas in the country because I'm still researching and learning more. But they get treated like they haven't been here. Like they're all immigrants. And it's like, nah, some, yeah, they traveled up here for better lives. But I mean, they're not all that.
Texas, all of the fucking Northern California should be all Mexico.
Yeah, it used to all be Mexico. And then you have Florida, you have New York, New Jersey, Philly, like where it's a lot of Latinx people who's coming from like Puerto Rico, the Dominican Republic, like Haitian, like all these different places, like Cuba. So like, yeah, they get next out.
So next one, this is a question I've been asking everybody recently, right? So let's suppose you have like a economically advantaged people up here, right? They have all the jobs, like they're rich, whatever, right? Down here you have economic disadvantaged people, right? Let's suppose these people up here, that they're supposed to have network events all the time, right? I mean, they're hiring networks up here, events up here. Should they be reaching down, hey, you people down here, come up to this event so we can hire you? Or should people down below find a way to come up here?
Okay. I think it starts here. All right. To let them know that you are qualified and you have that access. So I'm coming down to show you, like, you have this. And then once there is a shared governance and safeness and me saying, hey, you can come to this event at any given time because, hey, here's the history we're showing you. Like, we've been doing this. We've been hiring. And we're here to stay. Now, we want you to show the effort of like, hey, we're going up there to their events because they're hosting something. I don't think historically it's been happening like that. It's like we'll throw an advertisement out and be like, oh, you can work on the ship channel. Come to us. You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, we can work on the ship channel. Come to you. We get some money. But what else? You know, Microsoft and Amazon is big on like giving people jobs and telling them, hey, we're going to pay for you. We'll pay for your education. But they're not like supporting truly of like how we help you understand what you can do in education. You don't have to stay in Amazon. Like if I'm paying for you to go get an education, I'm paying for you to go get an education of knowledge. If you say, hey, coding is not for me because this stuff is super boring, go get a associate's arts degree or go get a bachelor's degree in sociology because you like working with people and you want to go be a social worker. Hey, we might have some social work stuff available down the line if we expand our company in certain ways. But I don't think companies are thinking like that.
Why should somebody go to college for this YouTube university?
Socialization. If we don't get socialization in 6 months, like our brain just starts functioning different, and those habits create bad impacts. And not only is college meant for socializations, it helps you build skills of interaction. Like right now we have these kids who don't know how to interact with each other because of COVID and other things. And then we have another generation of alphas to where they don't need anybody. They're so independent. They learned everything off TikTok. So what can you tell them as a parent or as anybody else?
But how can you justify, I think college increased by 10,000% since the 70s, right? How can you justify the high cost of college when like you just learn all for basically free on YouTube?
So
and you can go to fucking nightclub to socialize, right?
So yes, you can learn a few things off YouTube, but YouTube doesn't teach you discipline. It doesn't teach you how to navigate distractions. So when you're in college, you set your own schedule. So this is teaching you how to be an adult. With YouTube, you can wake up at any day and be like, oh, I'm going to learn that. I can do some DIY work. Do it yourself work, right? And it'd be cool, but at the same time, it's not helping you build a skill to where I can work with different cultures and so on, like, or learn how to be patient and listen to someone who's giving me directions outside of the skill that I'm trying to build off YouTube. Like, you don't get that unless you go to college.
Okay. So talk about toxic masculinity.
Oh, shoot. I think toxic masculinity is a trait that was inherited through enslavement of how we figured what a man is supposed to be and the toughness of a man. When an enslaved person was being beat, they would have to take on and endure this pain in order to be a great warrior. And they also have seen how households dynamic was ran. So even when enslavement stopped, you had a lot of enslaved people who saw how households was being operated on in the structures of when you have money and what a woman's supposed to do. And these things trickled down for generations. And then also with the decoding of the Bible and folks saying, hey, this is what the Bible is saying, and not truly researching on what God love is saying with that same message. And it has caused us to create negative frameworks and stereotypes that go into how we serve that as a practice.
So talk about your PhD dissertation.
Like EDD.
How hard or easy was that?
It was definitely hard. I never wrote like that in my life. Like
it's like 100 pages, right?
Yeah, it was 100 pages. And I had to focus on the exclusion of African-American boys in the K-12 school system. And it's so much research.
And does someone pick that for you or you pick yourself?
I pick it myself.
And does someone have to approve it or something? Or?
Yeah. You got to have a chair who's over the whole committee. You got to have a committee of folks who say, hey, I'm going to read your stuff. And they all have special skills in writing a dissertation.
And when you're doing this, you're like, man, this is my life's work. I love doing this. You're like, man, this fucking shit fucking sucks. I got to do it to get to my goal.
I mean, both. Because, I mean, it sucks because you got to write it. And then you can write like 50 pages and they'd be like, all of this was trash, but two. And you're like, wait, what? And they're like, yeah, write all of it over. And it's like, yo, I spent months on this. And it's like, so, and you're going to do it again. But when it's your life's work, you're like, okay, But shoot, sometimes you just fall out of that. Like, man, I don't even think this is my life work no more because y'all just keep rejecting my papers. So it took a while for me to be like, okay, I see what they want me to do and how to do it. And that's just like with life. Like, I probably come in and be like, I know how to write. I know how to do all these things. Here's what I'm presenting to you. And they're like, nah, it's trash. It's
yeah, all the power, yeah, right?
Got it. So it's a power, you know, shift and take, you know, for 3 to 5 years.
So mm-hmm. like, you might not know this, like, what percentage of people who start a doctorate actually finish?
Depends on how big the cohort is, but I would say a good 60%.
Finish, okay. That's pretty high.
Yeah, because in your first year, depending on if you were in a quarter system or a semester system, folks quit the first semester, first two quarters, because it's just too much.
When did you know you want to get a PhD? Was it back in high school and college? Like when it hit, no. I won't get an EdD. Like, I want to get a doctorate.
It was right after my master's. So I wanted to be a lawyer.
Okay.
I thought I was going to be a great lawyer.
I remember you telling me that.
Yeah. And then my LSAT score wasn't great. Mm-hmm. So I had this guy, he went to Southern University and he had his degree and he had an MPA. And he was like, I think you should do like dual role. So if you get into your MPA and, you know, you make that same score that you did, they'll like get you into the doctor degree and you'll be more profitable. And that didn't work again. So I was like, hold on, man. Let me go on ahead and just think of something that's going to like pay my bills. So I was like, I need to go and get a higher degree. And I was seeing how much all these principals were making. I was like, hold up, man, maybe I need a doctor degree. So I went to go get a doctor degree and I really didn't have no passion, but just to get the degree until I met, you know, the main professor. And he was like, yo, you dope. Like, you can do this. And I was like, wait, you see me? And he like, nah, for real. Like, you really dope.
He has some imposter syndrome then?
Yeah. And he was like, you really are dope. Like, you can do so much great things. And we just wrote an article together not too long ago called I Don't Think They Like Us, anti-black practices in the school system. And yeah, it's been amazing ever since. So,
what is an underrepresented person, right? Is it based on color, race, economic, like is a white person Appalachian Mountains underrepresented, or is it only based on color?
Economic resources. Economic resources, and yes, sometimes race plays a part in economic resources just historically in this country. So it's twofold.
So if you had the power to change anything about, like, anything in the United States, what would it be?
Shoot. Can we get a lick in strip clubs? Nah. I know. I'm saying everywhere, you know?
So funny story fast. So I had a good friend of mine come visit one time, right? And he's like, man, let's go to strip club, right? Man, dude, you want to go to strip club, right? Let's go to strip club, right? So finally, we're strip club, right? We were in there for 30 minutes. First thing he said, Jason, you're going to tell me Washington State had fucking Christian strip clubs.
Wow. That's crazy. I would say just make school free.
Like college, everything?
College. Like at college, school free. So now we see who actually wants to pick up different knowledges and skills for them to do a particular job and how that can impact their community without having a strain of having to pay anyone back when you come out of college. That's one of the biggest things too. We come out of college in poverty again. Like, we was trying to get out and now we picked up loans and all this other stuff. Like, it's still keeping us in the cycle.
this is my thing, that's right. Like, a lot of people say, like, forgive loans. So I don't believe in that. My thing is like this. Like, I think the fucked up thing, like, suppose you take $100,000 loan, right? Mm-hmm. You should pay that back. This fucking 20% interest, that's fucking straight bullshit, right? I think it's the interest that kill people, right?
Yeah, let's have a discussion about this, because okay. I'm big on this one. So, all right. Let's say I'm trying to go to college. I got the grades and everything. I can't afford it. But I got the grades.
Yeah.
Like, and there's no more scholarships. So you telling me the kid who's trying to change, you know, their economic situation, and they took out the loan, they gotta pay that back, knowing that truly they're not gonna be able to get out of the economic situation, because like $200,000.
Okay, two things. First of all, somebody failed that kid by letting them take a fucking bachelor's degree from New York University with a degree in fucking basket weaving. They get no job. And then why should someone who like didn't go to college as a plumber help pay that degree back?
Okay. So I see it on the standpoint of like taxes, right? But even with taxes, we are paying things that we all don't agree on.
See, now you're using fucking common sense on me. Not fucking fair.
I'm just saying, we pay taxes on some stuff that we don't agree on. But I feel like if we're saying we want to be economically diverse and provide equity, then that means we must compromise on a way that we disrupt the injustices. Because historically, we know that we have continued to put a burden on individuals. I'm not just going to say it's black and brown, because you even got white families that are paying back loans, right? Putting a burden on somebody to say, hey, the American dream is to go to college. We don't have that much scholarships for them, period. So we don't have that much scholarships for them, period. How are they going to get the money? Some can work, but it's going to take longer. And if it's going to take longer, I don't know your situation. So we all can't go to the army either.
How about this one? Like, this, like, I'll make this up, right? Let's suppose some person goes to college, liberal arts college, because it pays a lot of money, and they get a degree in painting, costs $100,000. Government pays it off. And then they go, okay, now I'm going to go to school for fucking poetry. Like, what is the fucking stop?
I think we should have certain regulations. So we could say your first degree, if you're going for a bachelor's, that's free. If you're going for a second degree because you are like, I don't know, I hated it and tried it and it just didn't work, then there's parameters of like how we provide aid for that.
So if colleges are free, should like someone tell you what degree you get?
No, I think we could do it like workforce education. So what workforce education is, they have certain degrees that they're paying for. And they're saying, once you get this degree, you're going straight into the work field, like with that degree. And I think if we do that with our college education, we're saying, hey, here's all the degrees that we're going to pay for you for free to go into. And these things transition straight into the work field where you can go get a job now. Teachers, so on.
Here's one for you. Let's suppose someone is like, you know, Southside Dallas, right? They go to junior college.
Okay.
They have the junior college degree paid off, right? Suppose someone, you know, the dad is a Wall Street banker, the mother's a fucking doctor, they go to NYU.
Okay.
So that should be paid off.
Yeah. I mean, think about it like this. Like, did they come from a family that had money? Let's say they didn't have money and they just became bankers.
I mean, you fucking Wall Street banker, a fucking doctor. You're fucking balling.
Is it? I mean, Wall Street, yes. Yeah. Wall Street, yes.
I mean, but a doctor, costs a lot of money.
But yeah, like a doctor, like when we get a doctorate degree.
So you're saying your kids shouldn't be punished for the richness of your parents?
No. Yeah, like right now, I got a doctorate degree. So everybody off the top is like, bro, you privileged. Without knowing the bills that I got and how much it took me to become a doctor, I got $230,000 in loans. Like, that's not even talking about my car loan. It's not talking about my house loan. Like, none of those things. Yeah. So it's like, in hindsight, I don't really got no money. Like, I make good money, but like, I'm paying back so much. So my son should like not be able to get his college paid for because his dad has a title that doesn't really even.
Maybe not a title, maybe based on income. Maybe you're like, you're making $5,000 a year.
500?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I can pay for my son's education.
But if it's free education for everyone,
then I can pay somebody else's education. Okay. Like, I'm willing to say, hey, if I'm making X amount of money, I'm okay with paying. Well, it's not even I'm okay with paying. I'm okay with paying taxes, period. Because there's something out there that people voted on because it's tough. And some of it I don't agree with, but I'm like, well, I mean, it ain't impacting me, but it's impacting somebody else out here. It's just like you seeing a homeless person. Like, I'm not homeless, but I don't know how you got homeless, but I have a heart for homeless people. Like, I don't want you to be out here. I don't care what you do with the money, but I gave it to you. Similar to when we paying off these student loans. Like, I don't know what you got your degree in, but hey, you got your degree. Go do something with it.
So talk about this, right? And this is my purview, whatever, right? This seems like in the last 3 or 4 years, probably more than that, when people get from college, whatever degree they have, their job is, and that has nothing to do with their job, with their degree, right? That's the thing that's fucking crazy. Like, people going to college to their degree and they can't get a job, and that they get a job something totally different. Like, did you waste your time getting this fucking degree?
Yeah, and no. I mean, it's not enough jobs out there for some of these degrees. Like, we have way more lawyers in the state. They're getting sued. A lot of schools here in the state of Washington are getting sued because we have way more lawyers that we produce than we have of jobs. And then there's like, it's not enough paralegal jobs either because those lawyers are now becoming paralegals, hoping that a lawyer position will open. And then some of them open their own practice and nobody's going to hire you because you don't have any.
So this is another good example. Like, maybe 5 years ago, it was come out. There was like 20,000 developer jobs in Seattle, all the empty developer jobs, right? And now it's too many developers, right? So I was at a network event last Thursday. It's a new tech notorious, right? And so the guy does red green, and part of his thing he does, he'll say like, hey, looking for a job, stand up. And like 80 people are there, 45 people stood up, and they go, my name's blah, blah, blah. 43 or 45 were looking for software development jobs. And they say, then next they say, you're hiring, stand up. No one fucking stood up.
Mm.
So all these developers find a job, and there's nothing out there for them.
That's what I'm saying. And we push people to STEM all the time. And it's like, there's not enough STEM positions.
And AI's taking all the fucking junior developer jobs away. Like, why am I going to pay you $200,000 a year and I can pay fucking ChatGPT $25 and do an API?
And I still don't know how to work it like that yet. I'm still trying.
I don't either. A lot of people have been on fucking companies on this shit, right?
Yeah. I'm like, how do y'all do it? Like, I be putting stuff in there and it doesn't even give me all that much.
Have you done it where like you go on your app, you'll say like, I've done this before. Do a video of blue elephants fighting left-handed crocodiles with red hair. They're fucking like fucking perfection.
Wow.
You have a video fucking that shit fighting each other.
That's crazy. That's super crazy. Okay.
So talk about mental health. Like when I was growing up, like if you were to say, I'm depressed or I'm like, whatever it could be. Look here, you weak motherfucker.
Yeah.
Like, and luckily, like one thing, like Generation Z gets a lot of fucking flack. One thing I give him credit for is a mental health day. Talking about mental health, right? Like when I was growing up in the high school army, like you would never say I'm depressed, right? It doesn't happen, right? But nowadays it happens. I think it's a good thing, right? But push back what I just said a little bit. I think too many people are like, they're always like, all the time, I need a mental health day. You can't take a mental health every day, right? Sometimes you got to like suck it up, buttercup, so to speak, and do the work, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what's your take on that?
I think mental health is important to talk about how there are so many different dynamics and how we process things in our brains. When it comes to, you know, taking a mental health day and things of that sort, we haven't discussed amongst ourselves as individuals on what triggers are, what spaces that we are included in that supports our identity that may impact us on our ability to do the job and work. We don't talk about family histories and traumas that show up every day for us that, you know, that can impact us. Mental health is, I think, what we start with if we want to dismantle and disrupt racism. Like, we have to be well in order to have these conversations. We also have to be well to do our jobs. We also must be well and having positive thoughts on making change. I don't like a lot of people taking a whole bunch of mental health days because I think sometimes it's performative. Like, if you just be like, oh, I hate this. And it's like, okay, and it's, I don't want to be here today. Now I'm taking the mental health. Like, that's different.
Yeah, from, like somebody take a mental health day and you like do the research. Okay, they take a mental health day every time we got to do this, right?
Yeah. But that also can be a trigger. So if I had a conversation with them and we are in and they have some training on mental health and that really wasn't a trigger. Okay, now we having a conversation, like you playing, right? Yeah. But if it is something real like that, then we need to have the supports ready for them so that they don't.
How do you like approach someone like, okay, you really tell someone, hey, you take mental health days, I think you're fucking lying.
You can't say that. But I think you can start by having a conversation of like, hey, what's going on? Like, I noticed that when we bring up this conversation or when we do some project, you don't really like being here on that day, or you are taking a mental health day.
That's when you gotta be an involved boss and, you know, mm-hmm. quote unquote care for your people, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Like, is there a way that I can support you? Is there something that, you know, you would like to tell me? And maybe I'm probably not the right person to talk to about it. Do you have a resource available for you outside of here, or do you need somebody here? And if it's something that I'm doing that's impacting you, right? How can we correct that? But, you know, some people don't have that safe space depending on your boss, or it might be your coworker to coworker. I just don't want to work with this person. I continue to tell y'all I don't want to work with this person. So I'm taking a mental health day. So it'd be so many different things. I think it starts with the conversation. You got to have a conversation.
But what if someone's uncomfortable having a conversation?
You got to bring in other resources. So, like, how do we bring HR into this? How do we bring in somebody that they're friends with or comfortable with? Or HR comes into this.
What if you have a small company or stuff, like maybe 10 people?
If it's 10 people and you have a person in there who doesn't have one relationship, we're doing something wrong as a company.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a very good point.
Like, you gotta have some type of relationship. Like, everybody, like, we all hate each other. We're doing something wrong as a company.
All right, next. So, like, I'm involved like tech startups like for a long time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's always diversity, inclusion, equity, all this stuff going on, right? There's like people getting hired, like, all this stuff, whatever. But if you look at the stats, I mean, of course, like, all the stats show like, more diverse your company is, the better everything is, like more money, more ROI, everything improves, right? But if you look at the stats are not improving at all, right? The stats are basically the same. Actually, they're going down last 10 years, right? Why do you think that is, right?
I would think, one, it has a lot to do with like the access of folks being able to move up in positions. Some people feel like you're only as good as that job, and they like you in that job. Mm-hmm. Like, they're going to hire folks to be in those positions all the time. But executive positions and bringing other folks in to get higher up in there, no. And then you start seeing, what is your value now? So, yeah, I'm going to leave. Like, I've been hoping to be the president of this company for so long, and I've been here for like 15, 20 years, and I watch y'all let somebody who don't look like me, who didn't even start the company the same time I did. They started 5 years later, and they rose up, and I have way more skill, and I'm the one coaching and consulting them. Yeah, people gonna leave.
What's some of your personal career goals?
Wow. I used to want to be a full-time professor, and I've been getting a lot of pushback from different institutions because in my classroom, I talk about what's real. I don't have a bad review on rate my professor or anything like that. I've been teaching for a while, and now I'm like, you know, I can take these skills outside of the educational classroom and utilize it in managing people. I want to be like a manager, like whether it's hip hop or folks who want to own their own food trucks or entrepreneurs. They're like looking for how they build structures for their own company or their own individual like acts of service, like, I want to be able to manage it.
So, personal question. How do you make sure, like, what's your plan in the future to do certain things? Like, how do you make sure, like, when your son grows up, that your son looks up to you and your son's proud of you? Like, your son says, like, that's my dad.
Be present. Try to be as present as possible. Make sure that I'm treating his mother with the most respect. I mean, our sons always look at the relationships that you have around them. And I don't ever want a time where my son feels like I'm treating his mother a certain way, because then he's going to envy me. So every time, even when I do have moments where I'm like, man, you know, like, why you have to do that? You know, and I have to like shift that, like, you know, how can we support each other. And yeah, it's for my son to look up to me. I just have to continue to have a great relationship with him. And most importantly, create relationships around me that's positive, that he can look up to, and make sure I'm treating his mother right and lifting her up.
What's something that you want to get better at?
Patience.
Yeah, that's my answer.
Yeah, so
I suck at patience.
I suck at patience when it comes to shopping. Like, sometimes I can wait, and it's like, you can wait 2 days. I'm like, nope, somebody gonna grab it. Like, I just gotta get it. Or patience with like, well, actually, I would say patience and like trust. I feel like sometimes when you love something so much, your trust can be compromised because you just don't want somebody to take it from you. It's like when you're a kid and you had your favorite toy, you wanted to keep that favorite toy. If somebody took that favorite toy, oh, it was on. And I feel like everything that I have sometimes is, I don't want to use the analogy of a toy, but it's something that I dearly love, and I don't want nobody to take it. And if I feel like somebody can take it, then I lose trust. I lose my ability to say that I have control over this. And sometimes you can't have control over everything, but you want to have a sense that what you feel like is supposed to be for you is giving back with love, and that is going to be there, and it's not going to go away anytime. Like, such as our parents. Like, I don't want to see my father leave this earth, or my mother leave this earth. Like, because my love came with that. And if they do, I don't know how I'm gonna operate, because now I'm like, you know, my trust was built in this person. So now I got to learn how to navigate without the people who brought me in.
Yeah, unfortunately, until someone cures death, you know.
Yeah.
That happened.
And you know, I used to be a person, I'm still kind of am, like when deaths happen, I'm just like, all right, all right. But with my parents, you know, I'd probably still be like, okay, they're gone. But inside of me, I lost myself. I lost a piece of me. So yeah. I have to still be like, it's going to be days when I'm like, man, I ain't feeling like that. Yeah. Like, I'm hurting.
Yeah, me, I get really fucking rough when someone dies. Like, when my dog died one time, I was emotional. Remember a frat D. McNeil?
Yeah.
He died. I was fucked up for you for like 4 or 5 days, right? Like, if someone died, I got fucked up, right? It was like, somebody I don't even know. Like, Prince died. I was fucking emotional for a few days. Hey, Paul Walker, Prince, I was fucked up for a few days.
Prince is everybody family member, all right?
Yeah. Like, I get really emotional when people die. Like, some random joke off the wall. I don't know why I get fucking emotional for some reason, right?
Yeah.
Really emotional, right?
Yeah.
For some reason.
I think it's due to, like, I lost a lot of people. And, you know, just, like, the area that I grew up in, it was always, like, a little rough. So you just... And it sucks to say we expected things to happen.
Yeah.
And I just took that with me. And, you know, I shelter my feelings, because I'm like, if I break, then I know it's going to take me to a place where I don't want to be. But it's been times where, you know, I come home, I'm numb, I don't talk to nobody. And people are just like, what is wrong? And I'm like, I don't know. Yeah. Like it's hitting me, and you know, I don't know. I still don't know where to place my feelings. I go to therapy still, and this is the course of like Black man healing. This stuff doesn't stop.
Yeah.
And the moment you feel like it only's gonna take like 1 or 2 hours of therapy, or you go a couple times, you gotta go for a long time, and
you gotta fucking peel back the onion, like all this shit, like. I'm like, you was 8 years old and your auntie told you you was a fucking piece of shit, or like you're 7 years old and,
it's so
and your grandmother
much.
gave your sister a bigger cookie than you. Like all that shit is like fucking a lot of trauma, is like fucking crazy shit.
It's so much like so like literally before I created Black Boy Hill, I was in a relationship with a young lady. And, you know, we lost a baby. And at the time when we lost the baby, we weren't seeing eye to eye. And
this is where you live in Puyallup, right?
Yeah. And you know, the baby, she had a miscarriage, and you know, we had to take the baby out, right? And literally the time that we had to, you know, take the baby, I had lost an aunt the next day. Tragic car crash. And I'm like, I have 2 back-to-back incidents, and I don't know how to take care of the person that I have shared a life with, and then how to take care of my family. My aunt, yeah, I was close to her. So, and grieve for my aunt. So I'm like, I'm lost. So I did the best thing in my ability, was to take care of a person that I had a child with that passed. And this was like the second child that I had that passed, and it was affecting me. And for her, it was impacting her because that was her first, but I was like, now I just feel like I'm a worthless person because I can't have a kid. Even though we wasn't, you know, seeing eye to eye,
that's interesting you thought that though.
Yeah, I'm like, this always happens to me. I just can't have a kid. Like, God is taking it away from me. And then boom, pow, another life is taken away. And I'm trying to console you, and we're not even seeing. And when I say we're not seeing eye to eye, we're not seeing eye to eye. But I have to be here for you because this is the life that was taken, you know, and we got to take it out of you physically.
And of course, you're not thinking like, you know, millions of people die every year, millions of miscarriages every year. You're just thinking like your own little bubble, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it took us a while to get past it. you know, I was still selfish in my ego. And in that time, I hurt her when it was all said and done, and I took care of her, and she felt like she was good. I still wasn't good, and I was treating it to where I was like, it's my fault and your fault. And it's like, no, it was never her fault. Like, and you know, now we're good. We have a good relationship now. Yeah, I would say like we're cordial, like we saw each other, like it's whatever. I mean, but we went through some stages where we did some work with each other to get past that. Cause sometimes when you hurt, you start placing your hurt on people.
What's that saying? Hurt people, hurt people.
Yeah, you start placing your hurt on people, and it shows up in different ways. And some of the hurt that I gave mentally, I can't take it back. And that's why I had to do the work with them alongside of them, because I don't want them to feel that, you know, that I wasn't trying to change, that I was this horrible person. She understood, but it was like I couldn't get past it because of tragedies that happened before. And once we came into our counseling sessions, we kind of uncovered that. And then there was tragedies that she had that I never knew about until, you know, those things started to surface and come out.
Why do you think people are so like, what's I'm looking for, like so hesitant to share what they're going through, right? Like, this is a bad example. Like you see somebody, hey, Dr. Webster, how you doing? I'm doing fine.
Yeah.
But you're not doing fine, right?
Yeah.
Like no one says, man, how you doing, Jason? Man, fucking, I got turned down 10 times by investors. Three people told me this. My relationship with my kids are fucking fucked up, right? Like no one says that. It always says I'm good.
Vulnerability. I mean, we have.
Do you think it's more vulnerable? It's like think, or do you think like please ask me how I'm doing, and instead of sharing whatever I say, like I'll say I'm going. I say I'm good. Is it more like I don't want to share because I don't think you're gonna help me. I don't think you, or because I don't think you care, or I don't like, or maybe I don't want to be vulnerable. Like,
I think it's all of it. I mean, it's like. Depending on whom the person is, they'd be like, this person can't help me. You probably just gonna take this information and just like tell somebody about
like,
it. You know?
Like you're gonna fucking decide like a bartender. Yeah. How you doing? I'm good.
Right. You know what I'm saying? It depends on the person and who you share
with. Hey, random dude, like blah blah blah. Like, dude, but even, I'm being fucking polite. Shut the fuck up.
But even as a friend, like we have egos, you know, where you always hear the saying, I don't wanna ask for help. Yeah. Like that's like a learned trait. You've seen somebody do it. Yeah. You've seen how they...
Everyone sucks at that.
Yeah, or you asked for help before and you got burnt. And now you're like, I don't even want to experience that hurt no more.
They try to take advantage of you and stuff.
Yeah, you don't want to experience that hurt no more. So, I think it's just tough. We're not as vulnerable as we can be. And like, I've been vulnerable in this space. I'm telling you what actually happened in the time of... me grieving that I wasn't a perfect person, grieving I was putting blame on another individual who lost a kid. Like, and a lot of people will be like, you're just this effed up person. And I'm like, no, I was.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you what I did. I ain't going to wait like Diddy and wait years and stuff like that. I'm going to tell you what I did, and I'm going to tell you where I was at, and I'm going to tell you how I grew, and I'm going to tell you how it's still an ongoing thing, because when you're hurt, sometimes if you have never had that skill before to understand what you're doing and also take the time to get better, you're going to continue to do the same habits. Like even after her, you know, I was still a manipulator. I was hurting Black women. I was doing all of these different things until it hit me. Like, You can't hide and run from the fact of what you're doing and who you are at this time. You need to go get help. And I was drinking, and that's when the suicide things start coming up. You know what I'm saying? And I went and got that help. And then I was able to connect back with her and try to put the work in alongside of her of like correcting some of the things that I have caused her. And then she did the same thing. Like there's things I'm not going to say that she did because that's her own story. But she did the work to correct it and so on. I feel like I'm becoming a better person. This is not a perfect person that people see now. I mean, I don't have some of those manipulative traits and stuff like that no more. Yes. But like just small senses of things, of being understanding of emotions, is stuff that I had to build up and learn because I didn't come from a family like that. I came from a family where I hadn't seen cheating happen. I hadn't seen physical abuse happen. And I never put my hands on a woman ever. But
ever
seeing ever.
So if a lady like socked you in the fucking mouth. Mm-mm. A lady fucking had a bat and fucking hit you in the head.
Okay. There was one time when I was in middle school. And shout out to the dude if he ever saw this, man. This young lady, I had a crush on her. And she hit me. She kicked me in my nuts. All right. And I was like, man, what the heck? And I like pushed her. Man, her brother picked me up and was like, you ever hit a woman or touch a woman, I'm going to beat you. Man, that man struck so much fear in my heart that I was like, I ain't even going to push a woman or anything like that for the rest of my life.
So what if there's a relationship, and we go back, we're talking about, what's a relationship where a lady's abusive, right? Like hitting a man, like yeah. Still like don't hit a woman.
I've been in those relationships before. I never hit them.
No.
Nah. Because I hadn't seen like the physical abuse and what has happened. Like my sister, my older sisters went through that. And I literally saw the pictures. I saw the bruises. I saw the hurt in her eyes. I'm like, I don't ever want that to be repeated like ever. I don't even want to be the man to do that.
Yeah.
So, and you got to understand the rage that I had that I couldn't even do nothing because I was such a young kid.
Yeah.
And I couldn't protect my sister. So why would I put that same hurt on another woman? Like, so I always made that oath. I was like, I would never put my hand on a woman.
Like, no matter what. Like,
no matter what.
Okay.
No matter what. Like,
so that's your values, right? That's your, like, your.
Yeah. And okay. Also, like, I don't want to hurt black women. Like, that's also one of my values. Like, in the beginning stages of me learning how to be a man, I took on everybody's thoughts and opinions and. Mm-hmm. Even with my emotions, how you express it, like how you got to be an alpha male, how you got to do this, like you know the stuff as men, like if a girl treats you bad, go get another one. You know what I'm saying? Like all of these different things. Until, like I said, the moments where I was trying to commit suicide, I started learning so much about myself. I was like, I don't have to be what everybody wanted me to be, and all of that stuff of manipulating and victim blaming and all of those things, that got to go.
Who's someone you have not talked to for a while that you want to talk to?
If I had to, like, talk
like,
to?
Like, some random person, like, maybe a good friend, relative, like, haven't talked to a while, like, you're like, man, I need to call this person and connect with them.
Man, my brother Eugene, man. You know, growing up, we was like,
the older brother, younger brother?
Nah, he's younger. So we used to be like two peas in a pot, you know what I'm saying? And we just distance ourselves in a healthy way. Like, we ain't never fight. We ain't never, you know, me and my brother never.
You had like a toxic relationship or something? Or
nah, we just, you know, as you grow as individuals sometimes.
You grow apart, right?
Yeah, you grow apart and you grow apart. And, you know, you don't.
Your brother's in Houston.
Yeah. So it's the ego thing, too. We both had a big, huge ego thing.
Ego's a motherfucker, right?
Yeah, we both had a huge ego thing that we didn't want to let go. And, you know, I think soon we're going to connect back. You know, also my brother who supported me with Black Boy Hill out here. We had, you know, a disagreement on, you know, something that I felt to me was like minor. I felt that it was minor and I felt a certain way about how we were supposed to go about it. He felt a certain way about how we were supposed to go about it. And we just didn't see eye to eye. You know, well, all of my relationships that it ended healthy. When I say it ended healthy, nobody fought, nobody. We ain't splurging each other's names out in the streets or nothing like that. I think we're gonna pick it back up and get it right.
So this might be the same question, but is there a relationship you have that you want to fix?
Oh yeah, I say my baby mother. Like, you know, she's like my heart, like she's my everything, you know. And for a while, you know, I could have handled situations a little differently, but it goes back to that saying, like when you love something so much and you feel like somebody could take it, you kind of just be like, oh, you know what I'm saying? Like, so you start expressing your hurt on people. Even if they did it, like you start expressing your hurt on people in ways of which you lose back yourself and your value. So I wasn't being the fiance or the baby father that I should have been because I'm just hurt and I'm seeing different things that don't align with what you're saying we're supposed to be. And now instead of being a man and bringing us back and trying to bring us back, I'm letting things slip and I'm letting things like not happen the way it's supposed to be. And I'm also expressing my insecurity so much on you that I'm losing you. So I would say, yeah, I would love for the situation to be back. I don't think no man doesn't want to be with his family, period.
From your point of view, what makes someone a successful parent? Like, what makes someone a successful mother, successful father, successful parent?
Successful mother and a successful parent or father. It's just when you put in effort to, like, help grow your family and your kid. I think it starts with how you build the structure of your family and how this is going to support your kid. It has to be kid focused, right? And then it also has to be like, how do we as individuals support each other and grow one another so they can see something to where they can find purpose out of? Like a lot of people, like in the NBA or NFL, when they do their acceptance speech, they always say God or they'll say their mother and father because they had such a positive impact. And I feel like that's how it's supposed to be, you know.
Hey, what time you got to get out of here?
Oh my gosh. Got like 7 minutes.
Okay, 7 minutes, okay. So this is my definition of success for him, right? So I used to, you know, most people think successful parents like your kids go to become a doctor, lawyer, millionaire. To me, I think it's more simple than that, right? Successful parent, it doesn't matter like your kids like you, love you, or like don't like you, whatever. If you're a successful parent, if like your kids are contributing to society, right? Yes, if basically if you have kids a job and paying taxes, you're successful, right? You're not successful if your kids are robbing, stealing, you know, on welfare all their life, then you're not successful.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the simplest thing, right? Like, yeah. Do your kids have a job and paying taxes? Are they contributing to society some kind of way?
Okay, so I get where you're going, but I'm going to throw something back at you. Okay. Play devil's advocate. They could be a tax-paying person, got a well-paying job, and got their own house, and can be a rapist, can be a murderer, could be all those things. Does that still make you a successful parent? Look, he's smiling.
Fuck you.
He's smiling. So I think it goes off.
No, you said contribute to society.
Contribute to society.
You're not contributing to society, you're raping motherfuckers. You're not contributing.
You're not, but those people who are doing that would think that they were doing something.
You're not contributing to society.
I'm with you. I'm saying those people like Diddy. We have seen him physically abuse people. We have heard allegations. I can't say these things are true. We have heard allegations.
Meek Mill.
But with those allegations and all of those, he would say he's contributing to society because he's putting out great music for artists.
He donated to a lot of HBCUs.
He's doing it. So it's like, okay, but you're still doing that. So.
No. See, that I would say is Pierce fail.
So I feel like it's when you carry the values, positive values from your family, that is creating positive impact on communities. And however that shows up, that's however it shows up. Because I'm just happy my sister's got a job. Like, I don't even care what the job is. I'm like, hey, they got a job. So they successful. You know what I'm saying? Everybody can't be a doctorate or all of this other stuff. They got a job. They can take care of the kids. They got a house. Cool.
So back to me being most about death. You ever watch The Big Bang Theory?
The show or?
The show, yeah.
I think I only watched like two episodes.
Did you? Yeah. You already watched The Young Sheldon?
Uh-uh.
No, okay. You didn't watch the show.
Mm-mm.
So we'll talk about that later, right? So is there anything I should have asked you that I didn't? Anything else you want to talk about?
Shoot. No, I mean, we kind of covered everything. People know I'm a professor and I run my own business and stuff. And I'm probably the greatest, you know, Houston Texans fan ever to exist on this earth. So I'm good.
So that's a good point, right? Before we leave, like, talk about the diversity of Houston, right? I don't know if people realize that Houston is like a big Vietnam community, big Jamaican community. Basically, any community is in Houston, right? Can you talk about the diversity?
Yeah. Yeah, so we're a big diversity city. When Houston was built, they were built on real estate development. So we still build out. And this real estate development has brought in different communities that serve the interests and needs of Texas. So you have big oil companies, you have big insurance companies, energy companies that's owned by different communities. And these different communities have set up their own sub-communities in our areas, to where we have been creating external goods for America. We have a Jamaican community. We have an African community. We have a big Chinese and Vietnamese community. We have a Latin, Honduras, El Salvador, and Mexican community. And it's just great. And we have built so many black and brown businesses in the city that we're kind of like the mecca of like new restaurants popping up almost every other week. So, yeah.
So besides soul food, what's your favorite food?
Oh, Asian food.
Asian food?
That was easy.
Easy?
Yeah.
You're the Asian food guy?
What? Man, Timmy Chan's is the best restaurant in the world, okay? They do this fast food Asian restaurant in Houston. They give you the fried rice, the chicken, and they got Kool-Aid. I don't know how these people learned how to make Kool-Aid like that.
Oh, yeah, they're red Kool-Aid.
Yeah, that red Kool-Aid good. All right, child. It's going to put you to sleep.
Not cherry Kool-Aid, but red Kool-Aid.
It's going to put you to sleep, y'all. That's all I'm saying. Like, straight up. And then I would say third. I can't even say Italian food. I only ate, like, spaghetti. That's what everybody be saying. They be like, yeah, let's go eat Italian, and it's just spaghetti. I don't know anything outside of that.
There's so many more foods than spaghetti.
That's what I'm saying. Somebody got to show me. Like, yeah. All I know is spaghetti. All
right.
But Mexican food, probably third.
Yeah. So, last question. We both are members of Phi Beta Sigma fraternity.
Yeah.
You're the vice president of your chapter.
Yeah.
Can you talk about some of the things you have going on in your chapter?
Oh, man. We're building so much. We're the fastest growing alumni chapter in the Western region of our fraternity. Currently, right now, we have a alumni chapter line coming out on the 25th in Edison Square at 6 p.m. We are making connections in the Tacoma and Lacey serving area where we're hooking up with the Black Collective, NAACP. We are supporting Black banks. We are supporting the YMCA with educational literacy and adopting schools and streets. We've been doing some big things. I think I would say probably every Saturday we hit up two Black-owned businesses and support. We have been putting on urban socials for folks to come out, network to. We also have been supporting and adopting schools and building up those educational literacies for those students with mentorship, providing opportunities for after-school programs and push in for in-school programs. And lastly, just bringing in quality brothers who want to impact their community.
So, Dr.Webster, in case no one's told you,
yeah,
you should be very proud of what you accomplished in your life so far.
For real, I'm still, I feel like I should do more.
Proud of what you've done so far.
I still feel like I should do more. I got so much that I want to give to the youth and so much that I'm still working towards with articles and just building myself up and just trying to take the toxic masculinity out of this us males so we can like really focus on being true to ourselves. I think I feel like I haven't did enough because in certain spaces, you know, folks be like, oh, you're so young, or they don't want to give me the opportunity. Even though I put in the work, I'm still like scratching the surface in some areas. But I think some big things is coming in these next 2 years to where people are going to like really shift their focus. But I appreciate you telling me that I'm enough. That means so much to me, especially when I don't hear it often. Like I don't hear people say, hey, like you're accomplished a lot, because some of the people that's around me don't understand like what I do. They be like, oh, he's just this guy we know. I mean, he's a doctor. He got a doctorate, but like we don't actually get to see it. You know what I'm saying? Because they're not in the colleges. They're not doing like some of them are police officers and stuff like that. So if you say it, they're like, oh, okay. All right, because it doesn't impact them truly.
Yeah,
like
they don't
that.
Realize the amount of work you put in, right?
No, they don't. And I'm like, if y'all only knew, you'll be like, wow. I'm like, it's hard as hell to write an article and get it published. Like, it's not something that just happens.
Have you written any books yet?
I'm working on one. It's called Gladiator School.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're talking about African-American boys and how they are built to be gladiators in all spectrums of their life. So it's going to be super, super dope.
What can people do to help you out with Black Boy Heal?
Lobby. Talk to your schools about like how we're trying to dismantle the school-to-prison pipeline. It starts with focusing on mental health. Getting programs into the school where we have liaisons that support the engagement in class with our youth. Support with our teachers, understanding how to work with different cultures, and then also learning what to do when folks have challenges and triggers. We don't, like, think of this. How is it that we have 1,700 students in some schools, right? But we have three counselors?
That's big bullshit.
Like, how can they support kids? Like, we really can't. So we're already at a deficit.
So here's one for you, right? So I think back, so I was stationed in Korea, I think 2007, 2008, I flew from Korea to Seattle to do my niece graduate, right?
Uh-huh.
And so my niece had like a 3.9 average, right? Like a high average, right? And so first kid, blah, 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 scholarship to blah, blah, blah. Second kid, scholarship, blah, blah, blah. Third kid, like 3.9, like Jessica Johnson, 3.9, scholarship to whatever, on. My niece, Destiny Wilson, 4.2.
Mm.
That was it. Like, what the fuck, right?
Mm-hmm.
Are you kidding me right now?
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, my niece was like, no one helping me out. Her mother, like, no one helping me out. Like, are you kidding me right? Like, you didn't think, like, fucking gold, like my kid's fucking smart as shit, right?
Right.
What the fuck's going on, right? But most people don't know. They don't know, like, to, like, fucking, like, shake shit up, right? You know, mm-hmm. like, you would think your kid a 3.9 average, right? Whatever was she at, right? All these kids have fucking scholarships. Your kid's average is higher than that on a scholarship, right? I was so fucking pissed, man.
I would too.
So fucking pissed.
I would too.
And what's crazy, my niece and sister give all these fucking excuses. They blame all on the fucking counselor, but all on the school. True.
In some sense.
Some sense, but yeah. Still.
Yeah, like if you got a 4.2, there gotta be some money pumping out. Something ain't right.
Like you're in a fucking junior college?
Right. Something's not right. Something's not right. But yeah, I'm just trying to show people you can come from the bottom up. Like I went to a Division I, had to start all the way back over. Went to community college, got that degree, came back, got the bachelor's, came back, got the master's, came back, got the doctorate.
Yeah, you definitely need to write a, you need to write a book of your life.
It's coming. I kind of don't want to open up those old wounds right now, but the Gladiator School would be good.
I think you need to.
Yeah.
Fuck, I got to bring it lock. So share your social media so people reach out to you.
Okay. So my social media for Instagram is Dr.Webster. And it's public. So you can see everything that's happening with Black Boy Hill. You can also go and understand what Black Boy Hill is by typing in the Black Boy Hill as in HEAL.com and understand the pathways and our understanding of how we build capacity for African-American boys to know about depression, anxiety. You can also order a shirt and gear from Black Boy Hill. I'm not wearing one right now, but every time that you order a t-shirt or a hoodie, it goes to the copay for our African-American boys. The rest of it, I pay out of my budget for them to get free therapy. We also have an app that you can download on Android and Apple called Black Boy Hill. It'll be a puzzle man running. This is something that I built 2 years ago. They have a chat function so they can chat with other guys who are on the app who, you know, need support. They have videos that support them with understanding what depression and anxiety is. And they also have a workbook for when they cannot reach a mental health therapist that talks to them about how to build up their identity. And they can connect with a therapist on our app via Zoom anytime from the hours of 11 to 3.
So you have a shirt. I don't know, cause I can't say the word, but you have a shirt that says, I'm not an N, N, N.
Yes.
Talk about that shirt if you can.
So oftentimes, and not just oftentimes, we're viewed in a way of we're only as big as our oppression. So sometimes, like when we do things out of order or out of behavior or out of character, they instantly throw these stereotypes at us. And sometimes folks try to live out those stereotypes because they only can see themselves as that. So the first thing says, I'm not a N-word with the E-R, and I'm not an N-word with the A. The last one says, I'm neither, because the neither part is I'm what my name is, or I'm something that should be amplified and glorified up because of the positive things that I'm doing.
Is it ever too late for someone to make themselves better? Like, do some people like, okay, you're like your past forgiveness, your past doing a better life, or can someone always redeem themselves to make themselves better?
I feel like you can. I think society sometimes won't let you depending on what the act was. But I feel like, what's the point of us talking about restorative justice? Or what's the point of talking about healing one another when things like this happen? Like, I would say we need to also do more research on like why certain individuals do what they do. Because I used to have a strong opinion about certain individuals, and I'm like, wait, this is just learned behavior, and nobody corrected it. So, like, where are they going to get it corrected if we just going to bash them the whole time? Like, or her, or you know, them. Like we have to like uncover and have that deep conversation instead of just saying, we're going to continue to label you. And this is what the labels do to us. Like we stay in that mind frame. So I think you definitely can redeem yourself and you definitely can rehabilitate, you know, whom you are. Like I used to steal laptops. Somebody could be like, oh my gosh, he's a thief. And or when I used to do crazy things in the community, they could say all of those things that I did, right? And now that I'm here, you know, are you still going to look at me in that way? Or are you going to say, man, this person changed? Like Chris Brown, he made a mistake when he was young. Some people have allegations where they're like, man, he's still making those mistakes. But for a person to admit the mistake, for a person to work on it, and for the person who was the victim to say that they forgive them, at what time do we as a community just be like, okay.
So Dr. Webster, you give us a lot of good advice, but can you give us any like the last minute advice or wisdom, anything you want to talk about?
Yes, I think my last advice that I want to give people is like, take your dream and put it into action. You know, one of my students, his name is Brian, and amazing, amazing, amazing story. And I was like, one of his biggest things is like, I want to show people how to take that dream and put action behind that dream. And that stuck with me. And I'm like, that's something I've been trying to do, but I ain't never had a word. So I'll be blessed if you can give me those words. But anything that you want to do, you have to work for. It's not going to be just given to you. Some people are outliers where it is, but we don't live in an outlier society where 90% of that is happening. So think about your dream, put purpose behind your dream, know that there's going to be order behind that dream in order for you to really commit to it. And once you commit to it, there's going to be a lot of white noise around you, right? But you have to learn how to treat that as like surface level things and aim high. And if you ever need resources, there are people out here for you, such as Black Boy Hill and, you know, other community resources. Like we need to combine together of the knowledge that we know for us to uplift each other. We shouldn't be working in silos. Like Black Boy Hill, I don't reinvent the wheel. If somebody is doing mentorship, hey, I'm about to take you over there for the people who's doing mentorship. Hey, or even, you know, other Black community therapists that I think are super dope. It just doesn't have to come from Black Boy Hill. I could take you over there to Washington Therapy Fund. Like, they dope people too. Like, I ain't in no competition with nobody. Like, all of this is for our people. So, yeah.
So, Dr. Webster, I'm gonna ask you this already, but how do you convince people to ask for help?
I think it starts with you thinking about, like, how you can come up out of this. Like the only way we can come up out of things is to be patient with ourselves. One, two, think about what you want as the end goal and outcome for the challenges that you have. If the outcome is needed to have you share this out, then who do you feel most comfortable and safe with to do that? There is somebody in our lives that we feel most comfortable and safe with, whether that's a physical being or it's a higher being. And if that's the conversation that we need to have with the higher being that leads us to having conversation with other folks, do that. Or if it stays between you and the higher being and you're doing some work behind it, I think those actionable approaches work. And as you grow more into being acceptance of saying, hey, I can let go of a few things and tell somebody something, sky's the limit. I just know that there's always going to be a process with it. So I would say put some urgency behind the process because it's your life and you don't want it to end no time soon.
Yeah, that's a good point, right? Like some people say, you know, like, I wish I was like, you know, in Texas and California or whatever. The only thing is like, as long as you wake up, right? As long as you wake up.
Yeah. Yeah, and sometimes some folks don't. Right. And we always think we have time. That's why I say put the urgency behind it. Anything that you want to do, put the urgency behind it. Right when I did the, when I tried to commit suicide, I tried to commit suicide four times. So when you see my hoodies and it has the four X's, that's what the X's represent. That fourth time, I was like, I want to live. Like, I really want to live. I'm in the bathroom, like, crying my eyes out. I'm like, I just want to live. I want people to accept me. I want to be loved. And from then on, I put urgency behind what I'm going to do. So everything had a pattern. Everything had an order. And I knew I also had to go make it right with what was going on from my grievances of my past. But yeah.
Dude, we could talk for like 3 or 4 hours, right?
Man, I was like, this is a long question. I was supposed to be gone 15 minutes ago.
Yeah, we're about to get out of here.
Yeah.
Man, Dr. Webster, thanks for your time today. We had to have you come back on. I appreciate you, everything you're doing.
Most definitely. Appreciate it, man. Appreciate it.
And to our listeners, thank you for your time as well. Remember to be great every day.